We're here on September 10th, 2001 to interview Judge John Godbold. The interview is being conducted as part of the Oral History Project of the United States District Court for the Middle District of Alabama, a court before which Judge Godbold practiced with distinction for many years prior to his appointment as a judge on the United States Court of Appeals for the Fifth Circuit. The interview of Judge Godbold is being conducted in his federal courthouse chambers in Montgomery by one of his former law clerks, Judge Dolores Boyd, who recently has been appointed United States Magistrate Judge for the United States District Court for the Middle District of Alabama.
Judge Godbold, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Judge, your distinguished career as a lawyer and a federal appellate court judge has spanned more than half a century. Because your home base during this entire time has been right here in the city of Montgomery, your judicial legacy is certainly of historical significance to the United States District Court for the Middle District of Alabama. As one of your former law clerks, Judge, I am especially honored to conduct this interview. I want to focus primarily on the times and forces which serve to shape your character, to influence your life's directions, and to inform your perspectives. So let's start at the beginning. And for you, Judge, that's going to be March 24, 1920, in Coy, Alabama. Tell us, Judge, where is Coy, and how long did you live there?
Well, not many people know where Coy is, Dolores. It's in Wilcox County, about 20 miles below Camden, the county seat, in a very rural part of Alabama.
How large was it?
Well, I'm not sure that that's an ascertainable figure. It's not really a place. It's a community with a country store and post office at the center of activities.
How long did you call this little community your home?
We left Coy and moved to Selma when I was about 4 years old.
So you were actually reared in Selma?
Yes.
Tell us something about your parents and any siblings.
Well, my father was a farmer at Coy, and when we moved to Selma, he was in his own small business.
What is your father's name?
Edwin. He was the youngest of five children. My grandfather was a country doctor at Coy. We lived in the same home. And interestingly, he raised six orphans from the community.
He did. This is your father's father?
That's right. And he had no family connection. They were just children who were homeless.
You had the opportunity to know your grandfather because he lived in the very house in which you were reared.
I wish that was so, Dolores, but he died a year before I was born.
I see.
But he was an interesting man. There's a piece in, I'm not sure the name of it, the Alabama Journal of History or something like that, the historians write for, that tells about his life and career.
And what is his name?
John C. Godbold.
Oh, you were named for your grandfather.
That's right.
Your paternal grandfather.
That is right.
A country doctor in Selma.
No, in Coy.
In Coy.
That's right.
Was it your father who told you the story of him having reared six orphans?
Well, my mother told me most of this because my father died when I was pretty young myself. But my mother kept us informed on family history.
Aside from yourself, did you have brothers and sisters?
I had two brothers.
What are their names?
My older brother is Bright, B-R-I-G-H-T-E, Bright Godbold.
Is he alive?
Yes, very much. He graduated from Auburn, became an officer in the Marine Corps, and retired as a general. He's had a distinguished career, since the Marine Corps and continues to be active in the affairs of Dallas, though he's now up in years.
And your younger brother?
Edwin, who also was a Marine officer who retired as a colonel and then became Secretary of the Southern Regional Education Board, which was a coordinating facility for colleges in the South, and he has now passed away.
Your younger brother then was named for your father.
That's right.
And your mother, what is her name?
It's Elsie Williamson.
A little bit about your mother.
Well, she grew up in a little community called Grove Hill, not too far away. And then when she graduated from high school, she came to Coed to teach. No post-high school training, but she came to Coed and taught, and that's where she and my father met.
As you look back on your childhood, what do you consider the attributes from your mother or your father that have most influenced your life?
I suppose my mother, Dolores, because I spent so many years with her. She was a quiet person, but tough, because she made her way through the Depression and getting us educated with no money, no means of support, really. And she just got it done and insisted that we do. Whatever the problem was, she insisted we attend to it, and so she had great influence on my life.
Do you recall how old you were when your father died?
I was 10 or 11.
So your mother really assumed responsibility right smack in the middle of the Depression, or
Absolutely.
Just after the crash.
Absolutely.
Judge, for those of us who've only read about that period, I know that you were very young. What are your memories of that time? How can you help us understand what it was like growing up in Selma, Alabama, being reared by a widower during the Depression?
Well, it was, for my family, it was not easy. It was the family was dependent upon the earnings of the three boys. We delivered newspapers, sold newspapers, used to deliver a circular once a month for a Selma business, mowed lawns, did whatever could be done to make money, and that's what our family made it on. Once in a great while, my mother might have a temporary WPA sort of job for a few hours a month, but that was not a regular source of income. We were really making it on what the boys could do.
For how many years did you and your family really feel the brunt of the Depression era?
I guess when the Depression ended, because
the entire time,
our status didn't change.
It did not change.
And when I graduated from high school and went to Auburn, I was the last child at home. So my mother moved to Auburn and made her home there for the rest of her life. And she was not employed and was not trained to work, had no training for any kind of employment. And as the boys got out of college and began making their own, well, we took care of her the rest of her life.
How old was your mother when she passed?
She was 94.
Did you know any of your maternal grandparents?
No. I'd like to add to that a little bit. Her parents died in what they called a cholera epidemic in that part of the state when she was fairly young.
Did she have?
She had two younger siblings. After her parents died, she took those two young people in her home, and they were raised as my brothers and sisters. Hmm.
So you certainly had role models early on in your life for selfless characters. A grandfather, paternal grandfather, who took in six orphans, and your mother took in her own siblings.
That's right.
Were there other influences, whether they were relatives, other people who served as role models for you during that period of time before you graduated high school?
I suppose not. I knew that I wanted to be a lawyer from very early age. And this inspiration grew, or at least was planted and then grew, because I delivered the newspaper to two or three different lawyers. And once a month I went to each lawyer's office, collected 85 cents from him, which was a month's news subscription. And I did that for several years. And so I came to know two or three lawyers pretty well, and they were kind to me, and I was in their offices every month. So this caught my fancy, and I knew pretty young this was what I wanted to do.
Let me get you to describe your grammar school period.
Well, I went to grammar school a few blocks from my home, a good school. The Selma schools were good. I went to a good school. Went home for lunch every day because I could go. I finished high school in 10 years. I skipped two grades. So I was pretty young when I got out of school.
Was it a common practice then for students to skip grades who were academically gifted? I know that now that's something that's sometimes frowned upon.
I don't know anyone else among my friends to whom this happened.
So it would be fair to say that you were a pretty good student back then.
Somehow I got by.
What kinds of things did you do as a little boy judge in school? I know that you had your newspaper route, and that was almost a source of work and pleasure for you.
Well, we had a lot of play in the neighborhood. We had a common backyard with several other homes, which was the center of the activities of the children in the neighborhood. There was something going there all the time, baseball or some organized game or something. It was an unusually good neighborhood group in a physical facility that was just right for us. That couldn't have been better.
Did that atmosphere continue through your high school years there in Selma?
Yeah, it diminished a little as we got up toward older grades, and boys began to be interested in girls. But through many of my Selma years, that was the center of boys' activity.
Mm-hmm. Did anything else happen along the way which cemented your inspiration to be a lawyer? Anything in high school, maybe a teacher or an activity that made you think, yes, this is the right decision?
Perhaps indirectly, this is so, because I participated in every debate and speaking contest I could get into. And there was something like this nearly every year for me.
You like to talk, Judge.
Like to talk, and I could make a public speech and did reasonably well at it.
Judge, did you form any childhood acquaintances in Selma that have followed you through the years, even perhaps as judicial colleagues?
not as judicial colleagues. I have two or three Selma friends that with whom I've remained in contact. As a matter of fact, I was trying to reach one of them by phone this morning. They were boys I went to high school with, and were kind to me, and that's about the only instance I can think of.
The Selma, Alabama, that's most widely known, of course, across the country now, is the Selma of the 1960s, which was noted for more controversy. I gather that the Selma of your childhood was a little more idyllic, with close-knit relationships, community feelings.
That is true, but of course, we need not dodge the fact that it was tightly segregated, and though the playgroup I was involved in had one young black man who often came and played in our group. And let me say, the bad incident at the Selma Bridge was not the fault of Selma people. That was, the reasons for that came from elsewhere. And unfortunately, Selma's taken the brunt of it, and they deserve it for other things, but not for that.
When you were a child in Selma between 1920 and 1936, how aware were you that segregation was the law of the land? I know that you recognized that there were segregated communities, but were there experiences or circumstances that made that reality come home to you even more closely?
Well, the reality of the facts of life came home to me. I had no conception of what the law was, that the presence of two societies was a matter of the law of the land. I didn't know that. I just knew it to be a fact. I worked, for example, with delivering newspapers every day for a good many years with a force of boys, who some of whom were black and some of whom were white, and we all got along all right.
Did any of the three lawyers who to whom you delivered newspapers ever invite you into their offices and attempt to educate you a little bit about the law?
No.
All right. But clearly that was the experience that made you think, this is what I want to be.
That certainly was one of those experiences, yes.
All right. Why Auburn?
Well, my two brothers had gone to Auburn. That's the main reason. I just never intended to do anything else. And for economic reasons, we all had to be, pretty well had to be in the same place.
How did you finance your college education, given your family's financial situation?
I went to Auburn with $11.
$11? How far did
that
take?
Auburn was very good to me. I got what was called an NYA job. That was 40 hours a month at 30 cents an hour. It was 40-30 or 30-40, I don't remember which. So I earned $12 a month. Worked in the registrar's office. In each month, I took my check to the comptroller, and they accepted it. And that's the way I paid my college tuition for 2 years. And I'd picked up some odd jobs in WIC and so forth along with it.
Had your brothers financed their education pretty much in the same manner?
Same way.
When you entered Auburn, I assume that you still had your inspiration to be a lawyer. Did you decide, or how did you decide, what type of discipline to pursue academically?
There was a standard pre-law curriculum for 2 years, and I followed that. And then I knew I was going to stay 4 years, so my last 2 years were largely electives that were business-oriented. Business and economic would be a better phrase.
How did you enjoy your War Eagle experience?
Oh, it was great. Auburn was a wonderful place to go to school.
Did they have a good football team back then?
They surely did. They surely did.
What other activities did you engage in?
Well, I did a great deal of debate on campus and sometimes on the road for the college. And a little tennis. And that's about the extent of the extracurricular activities. I worked for a time for the Glomerata, the annual. The editor and business manager were elected, and the business manager was selected, who then didn't do much of a job, didn't work at it much. And the college had to come in and find somebody to sort of take over most of his activities, and they asked me to do that. So for a year, I was sort of de facto business manager of the yearbook, though not having been elected to it. And whatever his salary was supposed to be, I got.
Did you also work on the student newspaper?
Yeah, I worked on that all 4 years, and the last year I was editor.
You had to be pretty young when you went to Auburn because you had skipped 2 grades.
That's right. I was barely 16.
Was that a difficult adjustment for you to make?
No, because I didn't tell many people I was just 16. I'm sure there were minor things once in a while, in a social sense probably, but no real impediment.
Judge, what are your fondest memories of your 4 years at Auburn?
Well, I love the work on the newspaper. And I was able to change the character of it a bit from sort of a campus gossip sheet to what was a pretty good newspaper. And interestingly, I had a letter to my last year from a Pulitzer Prize editor offering me a job.
Who was that, Judge?
Grover Hall, Sr. We sent the plainsman to the advertiser every week, and I got one or two comments from him through the year. And then at the end of the year, I had a letter saying he had a job for me, and I had to turn it down because I was headed for law school.
Grover Hall Sr. won Pulitzer Prizes when he was with the advertiser,
didn't he?
That's
right.
You say that you changed the character of the newspaper from the usual college sheet, college gossip sheet you expect to find at most newspapers. Did you tackle any heady issues back then, anything controversial, or how exactly did you change the character of it?
Well, I really meant change of character, perhaps in a more physical sense, although we did branch out to newspaper came out twice a week, and we branched out to carry a couple of national columns for the first time, national news columns and commentary and so forth. And we tried to take a firm position on a lot of issues that was a little different from the way the newspaper had been up till then. I remember, for example, we insisted that there ought to be aid to Europe, and this was the time of the Destroyer deal with Britain and that kind of a support, and but ought not to ever get into the war, just give help. The executive secretary to the president at that time was Ralph Drawn, who later became president. I worked in the registrar's office my first 2 years, right down the hall from his office, and he was very kind to me, and we got to be good friends. When he became executive secretary to the president, I was the editor of the paper, and he made sure that we stayed in contact. He never told me not to print anything, but occasionally he would ask me to come by and talk to him, and he would say something like, "Why don't you think about so-and-so? Maybe that's important to the school." And so I had, through his voice and his influence on me, I opened up a lot of things that had not previously been subject of a student newspaper. And I'm glad to say the Plainsman has kept that sort of spirit. You know, they're deep in the middle of the fight among the Board of Trustees at Auburn. In fact, they're one of the litigants against the Board of Trustees.
Auburn is very special to you, Judge.
Oh, yes.
I believe that you have been honored by your alma mater. Was it in 1982 that you received an alumni achievement award from Auburn?
I'm not sure of the year. I think it was 82. Auburn set up for the first time an achievement award for
the humanities, I believe.
For excellence in the humanities. And the first year there were three of us selected, and I was one of the three.
Anything else special happened to you while you were at Auburn?
Well, I met the girl I married. That was pretty important.
Well, tell us about that. That is very special.
Well,
how and when did that happen?
Betty grew up in Auburn, and her father was a teacher there and on the faculty. And we met, by our junior year at her sorority dance. She's always made a great event of it because she says we've never been introduced. Those were in the days when there was what one tapped a man on the shoulder and he stepped aside and you changed partners. That was break dancing, but a different kind than from the break now. And though I had never been introduced to her, I knew who she was and she looked most attractive. And I broke on her, and we liked each other pretty quickly.
Almost immediately.
Almost immediately. She says she was so excited that she went out that night and had her first bottle of beer.
You were a junior at that time?
Yeah, I was a junior at that time, and we had a happy year and a half there. And I went off to Harvard to law school, and she went off to New York to graduate school.
Did you go your separate ways knowing that you would unite as husband and wife?
I'm sure we had thought about it, but we were not formally engaged.
But you were not formally engaged at that time. You graduated to Auburn in 1940, and how in the world did you go from Auburn to Harvard?
Well, I just went. I had a little money, enough money saved up to get there. But
why Harvard? How did you go through the process of selecting what was surely the top or the premier law school in the nation in 1940?
Well, that's the way I wanted to go.
You wanted to go to the top?
To the best law school in the nation. And it certainly was at that time.
And how difficult was it then, Judge, in 1940? To get admitted to Harvard from Auburn? Surely your grades must have been tremendous.
My grades were good, Dolores, but Harvard never told me so, but I suspect I was a beneficiary of a desire to have a nationally based student body. If I'd lived in New York, I probably never would have gotten in. But they didn't get a lot of applicants from Alabama, I'm sure, and I'm sure they wanted two or three. So I was just that lucky.
Did you apply anywhere else?
No.
You went for the top?
I went for the top. I'll have to tell you that when I had been accepted, but when I arrived, I had to go through an interview with one of the faculty members, and innocently, I said I had been to He said, "Where'd you go to undergraduate school?" I said, "Alabama Polytechnic Institute, often known as Auburn." He said, "I thought Auburn was a prison in New York." So I was just fortunate to get there, and it's a wonderful school. Not a place one would ever love, but a hard, tough, intellectually stimulating, demanding course.
You did not find it intimidating coming from Coy, then Selma, and Auburn to be in Cambridge, Massachusetts?
No, I was intimidating, but not intimidated, but I was struggling at the time. We all were.
Now, how did you finance Harvard, Judge? You told us that with Auburn, you pretty much worked your way through. Did you
I'd saved up enough money to at least get into Harvard and get going, and each one of my brothers sent me a little check each month.
You were there only a year before you went to the military, but let me ask you if you would describe that first year at Harvard. What are your memories? Everybody has a recollection of...
It was demanding, Dolores. I found out right away that there were a lot of people there who were all brighter than I was. It was a fast track. Second, I had to... The only real problem I had was learning a different method of being educated. At undergraduate school, so much of one's learning was as though it were in a square box, and if you learned what was in the square box, you were okay. I got to law school, and I didn't find any square boxes. I found lots of square whirling crowds of things that I didn't know anything about, and in which I had to think my way through it. There were very few, we were given very few answers. We were given lots of background, and then the teacher was off on another course or another matter, and one had to figure out his own answers. And I found this method of teaching very frustrating. It took me a good part of my first year to learn how to learn.
It's a good way to put it, Judge, to learn how to learn.
Oh, my. I kept waiting for the answer, and there wasn't any answer. If I wanted to know the ultimate answer, I had to go to the library and figure it out.
Had debate or any other activity prepared you for this Socratic method or this Harvardian method of learning how to learn?
It had not. Well, there was lots of classroom dialogue and question and answer. The Socratic method was nearly used almost entirely, almost solely. But I could follow the dialogue. I just wasn't, I was often lost in the clouds. What is it we're talking about? And it took a while to catch on to that.
But you did.
I got through.
And you made it through that first year.
Made it through the first year.
And during that first year, Judge, did you and the future Mrs. Godbold, who'd gone to New York to graduate school, maintain any contacts?
Of course. That's why she went to New York. Her sister lived in Connecticut, and several times during the year we met at her sister's for the weekend.
Did you become engaged during this first year of law school?
No.
All right. No. Of course, you were aware when you went to Harvard about what was happening in the world and the fact that the country was on the precipice of another war.
One had to be 21 to receive his commission in the reserves. I graduated from Auburn, I wasn't 21.
You were just 20?
I was 20. And I was reached my 21st birthday in March of my first year, ordered me to duty as soon as I was commissioned, and I had to get a 60-day extension to be able to finish my first year exams, because it was March, you see, almost the end of the first year, and there's no problem. The Army readily gave me an extension, and after that extension was over, I was ordered to duty.
You really didn't have any choice about your division of military service. The Army drafted you.
They didn't draft me. You see, I'd had ROTC at Auburn,
all right,
which qualified me for a commission as soon as I got to be 21.
You were able, though, to get the extension to finish your first year exams.
Yes.
And then where?
Immediately. I was sent to Fort Bragg, North Carolina, and was there, I guess, a year maybe.
Were you transferred then to your European duty station?
No, I moved around quite a bit. I went to school at the Field Artillery School at Fort Sill, Oklahoma. Then I went back to Fort Bragg, and then I went back to school at Fort Sill. I went to three different schools at Fort Sill, which is the Field Artillery's chief training ground. And then I was assigned to duty at Fort Sill, and was there a year or so, and then I joined the 70th Infantry Division, which is the outfit I went to Europe with.
And that was an artillery division, a field artillery?
Well, it's what's called, it's an infantry division of about 12,000 men.
12,000?
Yeah, but it has a field artillery unit of four battalions, which is, oh, probably 2,000 men. It's just part of the larger unit.
And when you went to that unit in that division, the war was going strong.
Yes. And we were trained for...
You were barely 21.
That's right. I was trained about a year in Oregon with the 70th Division, and then we went to Europe.
Was that a culture shock?
Oh, yes. I must tell you one other thing while we're talking about it. When I was at Fort Sill, I had two or three different assignments, but the last assignment I had was I was battalion commander of a battalion of black troops.
All black troops?
All black.
So the Army then was strictly segregated?
Strictly segregated.
How then did you end up being commander?
They all usually had a white commander. Maybe two or three whites, but I happened to be the only white, and commanded this battalion before I left Fort Sill.
What was that like for you, Judge?
Well, I already knew. I already had a conscience about black-white relations, and I was comfortable in the job. I had right at my elbow two of the best non-commissioned officers I ever saw. I was aware from my school days at Fort Sill, because I went through three schools out there. That the black soldiers were not given a proper status. There were three firing batteries, we called them at Fort Sill. They were the ones who shot the guns. There were three white batteries and one black battery. The black unit was regarded as not as good, not having as much status. There was grumbling about them. There was some feeling that they couldn't perform or didn't perform. I saw all this and I didn't like it. So it was true then that, I mean, the idea of differing units and the idea of different abilities was present then. When I got to Europe, I spent about a month in the same wrecked house with another captain from, of all places, Mississippi. My 70th Division units were all white field artillery units, four battalions. He was in another unit, and his unit was all black. Here's a young officer from rural Mississippi. One white officer with a black battalion. And he fought this every day. I don't mean adversely, he was fighting every day to get them recognized as capable and able and carrying their share of the work. Because there was a lot of feeling that I thought was unjustified, that they were second rate, and he didn't think so. And I watched him and sympathized with him, and he made a great impression on me.
Was it almost a losing battle, though, fighting to bring about equality for the black unit there? And I say that simply because my recollection of history is that it was after the war when Truman finally issued the directive for
desegregation. I don't know that it was losing. Maybe not losing, but maybe hard to improve it.
I would think that with your being from Alabama, with him being from Mississippi, the two of you probably were not looked upon with a lot of regard by your other white officers for even caring. Would that be understating it?
I don't think that's so. That's never seemed to me to be a factor. It was just that they had a different view than we did, and that was it.
How large was the old black battalion that you led in Fort Sill?
Gosh, that's hard to remember because we were not a firing battalion. I would guess 800 men probably.
Judge, you were so young and having spent most of your life in Auburn or in Alabama, one might reasonably inquire about the source of the conscience that you had even then about equality. And I would venture to suggest that your family background, perhaps your grandfather, your mother, your father, and your nurturing during childhood contributed somewhat, and perhaps you have some other explanation for it.
I began to have a conscience about race relations when I was pretty small, and certainly had it by the time I was in high school. I cannot say that it came from home. There was no sense of discrimination in my home or in my family. But this was simply the way life was, Dolores. And but as I say, at high school age, I had begun to feel that I didn't like it.
I'm confident that the soldiers in that battalion appreciated your leadership.
I hope so. We had some good ones and we had some bad ones.
Well, that's...
I had one soldier who had stayed in trouble all the time, and every time he got in trouble, he wrote Ms. Roosevelt. And I got a letter back with a great line against it, which meant send it directly to the subject and read it right away. But I got a letter from Ms. Roosevelt every few weeks about Willie Jordan.
So the stories of Eleanor Roosevelt's intervention are not exaggerated at all.
Oh, yeah, I had to reply a number of times as to why we had him in jail or waking out specially or something. And as soon as he got loose, he was off again. I finally cured him.
How did you do that?
I promoted him to corporal. On the advice of my senior non-coms, who said, can we get rid of this fellow some way? And said, let's promote him. So I promoted him, and things got better.
Tell us about Europe and the war experience that you found.
My division came into Germany, into the continent, rather late. We came in through Marseille and southern France when the toughest fighting in Normandy was over. And we came north and got into combat considerably further north, and it was, I don't mean to indicate it was a picnic, but it was not nearly so difficult.
To what extent did did you come into contact with the Holocaust?
With the Holocaust?
Yes, sir.
In two instances. When the war was drawing to a close, my unit I commanded, which was the headquarters, battalion headquarters, battery, it was called, it's about 180 men, were assigned to occupy a little German town where there had been a factory operated by displaced personnel from Eastern Europe. And I had been in town only not 24 hours when I realized that something was out of kilter in the town. The conduct of people, their manner, their clothing of the Germans were not normal. And somebody finally tipped me off that the displaced people from the factory had been disposed of. So we took enough people into custody and did enough checking that we found the burial site out of town and made the downtown people dig the site up. And there were 85 bodies in there, men, women, and children, all nude. They'd taken their clothing, taken all their possessions, and shot them all. And we had the townspeople dig the bodies up and cover them decently and had a funeral service and reburied them.
They were all Jews?
No, they were Eastern people, Poles.
Gypsies?
Not gypsies, Poles and Lithuanians and Latvians and people like that. The second instance, we moved soon to another town, and a small factory there that had been run by the displaced people. Before the German, they were probably semi-official Nazi troops, SS troops we called them, or they may have even been civilians. They had taken the leader of the displaced worker, who was the one who had leader of displaced workers, who had been their spokesman and an irritant to the local people. They had crucified him on the wall of the factory.
You saw that?
And I can't say that what his ethnic or racial background was. I doubt it, sort of doubt that they would have had a Jew running the factory. But they disposed of him before they left town.
Judge, I know that war is not something one expects to find lacking in cruelty, but I'm wondering, because you were so young, what kind of impression this particular war and your interactions in Europe left you with. And how you handled that. I can only imagine myself similarly situated. And maybe I'm overemphasizing your youth, because you had, after your father died, begun working and probably maturing greater than your years. But talk with us a little bit about the emotional impact of a 21-year-old, 22, 23, 24, during that time, coming to grips with the cruelty and the violence of that particular war.
Well, I believed we ought to be in it, in the war. I believed I was responsible for being in it. I did not resent being in it. And I wanted to see the German threat, and it was a threat, be defeated. And I was in post-war Germany one time after the war, and I just was not comfortable around the Germans. And that may have been a deficiency in, on my part, but there were helpless people in Germany who knew, didn't know how to resist and couldn't resist. But there were lots and lots of people who cheerfully went along and enjoyed what they were doing. And I just never could be real comfortable with the Germans as a whole. And one of my fellow judges greatly admired the Germans, and he used to tell me I was all wrong, and I just had to say I can't, haven't gotten over it. And
you had a strong sense patriotically that American interests were at stake then.
Oh, I don't doubt that at all.
The enemy was clear, and the enemy was Germany at that time.
It was at that time. This was a search for world domination. And England would never have made it if we hadn't come. And I thought we were doing the right thing. I still think so. I wonder once in a while if I should feel more comfortable about the Germans, but I haven't forgiven them quite.
What
and they were one other incident when we in a little town where the usual factory, and I saw no physical harm to the people running the factory who were Ukrainians that the Germans had captured and brought there. But when we arrived, they were starving. There wasn't a lot to eat, but the Germans shared none of it. These people were starving. And we took our food supplies and took care of them until we could get arrangements, until I could get arrangements for food to come in from elsewhere. But they were so terribly hungry that they wanted anything to eat, they could get, anything. We used to go through our chow line, and as you may know, after you've eaten, you've got to wash your own mess, get out of the in a boiling water and sanitize it and so on. Before you do that, you got to scrape it. As people went through the line, they scraped all of their food leavings in a great big barrel, and the people were just waiting there to get it. A barrel full of mixed glop. And they were desperate to get it. And I had found a young Jewish man to be acting mayor of the town, and then put him into office. And I questioned him, said, I know you, why can't your town people at least share a little food with these people? He said, they're starving too, and they're not going to share it with anybody. It was an interesting experience in that I threw out the mayor who was there, who was a Nazi, had to find somebody to take his place and do the best he could with the needs of the city, and I found this young Jewish architect. Mm. And persuaded him to be the acting mayor, and he did surprisingly well. And I never did understand how he had escaped some of the German
atrocities,
harms to the Jews, but he somehow had survived. And he was my acting mayor, and the conservative Nazis in town thought that I was out of my mind, laughed at the idea of having a 20-something-year-old Jewish boy as a mayor. They had to put up with him, but they did.
Now, you were in Germany. Where else did you have any tours in Europe?
After the war was over, I left Germany. I was ordered to come back, well, to go to elsewhere in France, to a camp in France, and join a different division which was headed for Japan.
How long were you in Japan?
Never got there.
Never got there. What happened?
We were deployed out through England, and we were almost literally sitting on the docks in England. We had 2 days more delay waiting for a ship. And the bomb was dropped, and all of the signals changed. And we, 2 days later, the QE2 came in, and they said it's too late to change all the plans, go on home. So my unit was one of the first ones home, though we didn't deserve to be. But we were headed to the United States, to the West Coast, where we were to be re-equipped and head for Japan. But we just never got there.
How did you feel when you heard the news about that, as you say, when the bomb was dropped?
Oh, we were delighted. Absolutely. We didn't know about the horrors of it, but I think that wouldn't have stopped us anyhow. We just knew that the war was ending and that the fighting would soon be over and we'd go home.
Are there any associations you forged during your military service that have remained with you as you have grown older?
Very few, because units were scattered, were from scattered people all over the country, or most of them were, and mine was. And one just loses contact with them.
Is there one thing about your military service that has served to shape your character more than anything else, or to influence any decisions that you made about how you would act as just a human being, or if you ever got the opportunity to practice law? How did your military service influence you?
It influenced me in this way, Dolores. Military unit, size of a division, and even the size of the battalion I was in, has people in it of all sorts and kinds. Good people, bad people, sorry people, well-educated people. People who come from the very low levels of society up to university teachers. And it came home to me, as it never had before, that there are good people of all kinds. They don't all go to the university. They don't all, not all well educated. But I was very proud of my people for the way they did that, their duty, and attended to it, and with their great strengths.
All right, Judge. You emerged from the Army, am I right, as a major?
Yes.
In 1946?
Yes.
Judge, I've always been fascinated about World War II because the men who served in World War II were going away from home for so long. And our modern-day perspective for Vietnam and Desert Storm gives the impression of some continuity with communications back home. And I've always wondered how in the world did the men who were away for 2 or 3 years keep up with family life? And for you in particular, I'm wondering how you were able to keep up with the future Mrs. Godbold. Did you?
The military had a system, what was called V-mail. A V-mail letter is the envelope, and it's about the size of a half sheet of paper. And you could write on that a good bit if you make the writing small, and then you folded it over and sealed it. And that was transmitted, I'm not sure how. I don't know whether it was flown immediately or whether there was some electronic or electric means of transmission, but that came home right away. And Betty could write me the same way, and the letter came not the next day, but very quickly. An ordinary letter with ordinary postage on it might take 2 or 3 weeks, but the V-mail came very quickly. And I got a letter from her nearly every day.
Somehow I thought that there was constant communication.
Oh, there was lots of communication.
And I suspect that was quite nurturing and heartwarming for you.
One incident of the letter communication, though, was all mail outgoing from us to the States had to be censored, or examined is a better word, and I had to examine every letter that anybody in my unit was sending out. And the main thing was one was not to reveal where one was or had been a day or two before. No revealing location. So I read lots of mail and tried to reassure all my men that the contents of it didn't concern me as long as it didn't tell where we were. But it was a chore that one had to undergo. But the contact was pretty good.
Now, had you become formally engaged before you left for your European tour?
Let me count back and remember, Dolores. I married before I went overseas.
Oh, you did?
Yes. I married when I was one of these, I was stationed at Fort Sill at the time. And Betty and I married then.
So she was Mrs. Godbold.
Mrs. Godbold, that's right.
And where did she live while you were in Europe?
She lived for a while with her sister in Pennsylvania. And she wanted to take some college work there, though she had a degree, but it was just a way to keep occupied. That didn't work out, and she went home and stayed with her parents in Auburn and taught some there. Taught in Auburn at the university until I got back.
And when you got back, you were where? You came directly?
I came to Fort Jackson, South Carolina, and was there about 2 months. And then I was discharged, and I wanted to go right on back to school, but I hit the semesters wrong. And so I had a delay of 6 or 7 months to get back to school. And I went to Auburn, and it's a demonstration of how hard up they were for faculty. Betty and I both taught for that that period of time in the mathematics department.
Both of you taught in the mathematics department?
Yep. And neither one of us a great mathematician, but we stumbled through it. And then in the fall, the Harvard second semester opened up, and we went on up back to Harvard.
And she accompanied you this time?
Oh, yes.
And you lived off campus? Or were there married student housing?
There was married students housing, but we couldn't get in it. And the only way we got a place to live was we bought a three-unit apartment house. Took my GI Bill benefit, and we bought a three-unit apartment, lived in it, and took care of it, and when we left after graduation, sold it.
So that you really took advantage of the GI Bill almost immediately.
Yeah, it worked out fine for us.
How did you fare at Harvard for the last 2 years?
All right. It was hard. It was demanding. And my first child was born while we were up there.
And would that be Richard?
That's Susan.
Susan.
Yeah. And she was born at Massachusetts General Hospital. And brought her on back to Alabama.
How do you assess your overall education at Harvard in terms of its subsequent value?
It's superb. It's good substantively because one is made to learn it. It's good intellectually because there were magnificent faculty who were making us learn it. It carried a lot of status, probably more than it deserved. And I think nearly all of us left it with great respect, but with no affection.
No affection because the task was rather arduous being
it's
a student
just,
there?
It's just a tough, tough, under tough. It took all I could do to to get it done.
Did law school, particularly after the war, give you any time for leisure activities?
No, not for me. Others found some time, but I didn't. I was just working all the time.
Did you have summer law jobs, clerking anywhere, interning?
No, as soon as we went, because it was the post-war program and they were getting as many people through as fast as they could, I went 18 months straight with no break. It was the equivalent of two semesters straight through. Had one weekend free.
So you left Harvard in 1948 armed with the Juris Doctor degree from the top law school in the country.
That's right. That's right.
I would expect, Judge, that you had many, many options as a young Harvard law graduate.
There weren't any jobs. Almost none. You see, all these young people had been off to war for two or three years, and they all came home and either went back to law school and finished, or they were already out and looking for jobs. The job market was very dubious.
Was that the factor which influenced your move back to Alabama?
Well,
or
Betty
was
that
always in your mind to come back home?
We thought we might, but we had fallen in love with Oregon. We'd spent a year out there. And I thought a long time about Washington, but in the end, Alabama won out, and it proved to have been the best thing that ever happened to us.
Why do you say that?
Well, everything just worked out for us.
You and Mrs. Godbold and Susan returned then to Alabama in 1948.
That's right.
And your next obstacle was the bar exam. Was that, did that prove to be an obstacle at all, or after having emerged successful from Harvard, was it a piece of cake?
Well, I was unusually lucky because I came back to Alabama about February, about the end of February, and the next exam was July, and I was fortunate to get employed right away. And so I...
Before you even set for the bar?
Yeah.
Tell us about that, Judge.
Well, as you know, I went to work for then Colonel Reeves. And...
You referred to Richard Reeves, who ultimately had his own distinguished career as a federal judge on the U.S.
Right.
Court of Appeals for the Fifth Circuit.
That's right.
Please share with us how you met him and how it is he came to offer you a job before you even passed the bar.
I came to Alabama some months before I graduated. He was the one lawyer in Alabama I wanted to work for.
Why?
He was the best there was. A friend of mine wrote, a lifelong friend, wrote him, who knew him well, wrote him a letter asking him to interview me. I did so. Only a few months before, he had left his old firm and opened his own office because his son was in law school and he was making way for his son to come with him. So he told me that he just didn't have a place. I then got a job from the Attorney General, or I thought I did. I went to see the Attorney General and secured from him a job, evidence even by a formal letter saying that he had the job placed for me. I went back to law school, finished, drove over icy roads to get to Alabama on the appointed day. We even came over some roads that were blocked off to be sure we got here on the appointed day. Checked in with the Attorney General, and he said, "I'm sorry, I gave a job to somebody else." So Colonel Reeves had told me if he could help me in any way to let him know. So I went back to see him and asked him if he could give me the names of two or three law firms he would recommend that I talk to that might need somebody. And he asked me if I still wanted to work for him. I said, yep. He said, when can you come? So So I went to work for him the next morning. It was just, I was just the luckiest man around.
You described Judge Reeves as the best there was. Help us understand the context for that glowing pronouncement.
Well, he was good in every way. He taught me nearly everything I know. And he taught me a lot I never had learned about human relations and standards and people.
Many people don't realize that Judge Reeves himself never went to law school. Share with us a little bit about his background and whatever else you learned.
He went to college 1 year at Tulane. And family had no money, and he came back to Montgomery and read law in the offices of the elder Hill. I'll tell you his name in a minute.
Was it John Blue?
Not John Blue, the generation ahead of him, I guess. It may be his older brother, but... And he read law, as they said, for I don't know how many years it took, and then took the bar exam and passed, and that was it. And he could master anything.
Patent case. Was he a trial lawyer?
Best trial lawyer I ever saw. Patent, give him a complicated electric machine to worry about. Give him the tax laws of Nebraska. He'd master it. And Dolores, when he walked in a courtroom, the jury liked him. His manner, his demeanor, his presence, his courtesy. He seldom raised his voice. He would never have said anything ugly about another lawyer or to another lawyer. And he simply had a manner and a temperament and a store of knowledge that he didn't always win. Sometimes he didn't have the case, but juries just liked and had confidence in what he said. That's a talent a jury lawyer needs, and he had it in wonderful way. He helped other lawyers a great deal. Lawyers, one office lawyers who hardly making a living, used to come to the office and say, "Dick, I got a problem. Will you help me?" He'd take 2-3 hours, help him out. They'd say, "Well, will you join in this case with me?" He'd say, "No, this is a case for you. You handle it." He helped many a little nickel and dime lawyer out of his problems.
I get the impression that he was the preeminent lawyer when you came home in 48.
He was. He was, not only in Montgomery and Alabama. He was the preeminent lawyer. He'd been president of the state bar. He'd done everything. He had a distinguished military career. And he had a great deal of political influence and power. And I just was very lucky.
You mentioned that he was establishing a practice in anticipation of his son joining him. Did he ever do that while you were with him?
His son was killed in an automobile accident about a year later.
Even before he finished law school then?
Yes, he was at Michigan Law School.
Then it was just the two of you, Judge Reeves and you, in law practice?
That's right.
What was that like, Judge?
Oh, it was great. Nobody could have asked for a better circumstance. He gave me as much responsibility as I could take. He was teaching me all the time. He used to have some client coming in to see him. And if he thought there was anything I could learn from watching them talk, he would say, "Let me get Mr. Godbold in here. Maybe he can help us." And I came in and just sat and listened. and learned. And he just was a wonderful talents and a great influence on my life. He had great moral standards, great personal standards. He had decided in his own conscience that he was from a very humble background, and he had decided in his own conscience that the treatment of blacks was wrong. And so when he came on the court, he made the great transition, and it was easy.
Well, he came on the court in 1951.
Yes, he was a Truman appointee.
So that you had the opportunity to practice with him for almost 3 years before then?
About 3 years, three and a half years total, I guess.
And am I correct that he was a president of the local bar?
He'd been president of the state bar. I don't remember about the local bar. I suspect so.
At the time of his appointment, was he still just a partner with you, or had the firm merged with any other lawyers?
No, it was just the two of us. And we'd practiced together with my name just with his. And then after
Reeves and Godbold?
No, just Reeves for a while. And then after he became confident that he was going to be appointed circuit judge, he changed the name to help me.
Oh. Hmm. Did Judge Reeves have a federal practice predominantly when you practiced with him?
He had every kind of practice except divorce, if he could avoid it. He did a little of everything. He was an all-purpose lawyer.
Do you know much, Judge, about how his opportunity came to join the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals in 1951?
Yeah.
Would you share a little bit about that?
Well, he had been a very close confidant of Senator Hill. They were very close friends.
And that's Senator Lister Hill?
Lister Hill. And Judge Reeves had been one of his really very tight circle of very close supporters. Worked with him in lots of things. I'm sure that, I don't remember whether John Sparkman was in the Senate then or not. I believe he was, and he was close with John Sparkman, but not as close. We were then in the middle of the fight between the Democrats and the Dixiecrats. The Dixiecrats, of course, were the people who, most of whom became Republicans in 1952. But there was a fight for control of the Democratic Party with Lister Hill and John Sparkman standing for the loyal Democrats and others trying to take control. And he was very much a part of that. And when after he left, I became a part of that. Judge Reeves had been in political affairs. He could have been governor of Alabama if he wanted it, but he didn't want it. And he had an influence on a lot of governors. Governor Sparks, who was pretty conservative, and Big Jim Folsom, until Judge Reeves got tired of fooling with Big Jim's indecision. He had a hand that reached everywhere, politically.
Was his selection or appointment process filled with any kind of controversy back then? Was it simply a matter of Senator Hill saying, I want this man to be judge?
There were always some aspirants around, but... The way it operated then, which is a little different from the way it operates now. If the two senators were of the same party as the president would simply take their nomination unless there was something really wrong with the nominee. If the two senators were of the same party as the president, and that happened in this instance, and it happened when I was appointed. And the White House didn't raise a problem unless there was something really wrong with the nominee. And if you had a split between the senators, it took some negotiating and work it out, though the president would still normally take the Democratic choice or the choice of the person in his party. Congressman had literally nothing to do with it. The White House had little, the Justice Department had little to do with it. And Judge Reeves had no problem. I never did even remember a name or another name being suggested. I was, came along 12 years later, I guess, and again, I had two senators, two Democratic senators, and a Democratic president, and I'd been working with the Democrats for 12 years, and I'd been chairman of the Democratic presidential campaign in Alabama in 1952 with Stevenson and Sparkman. Mm-hmm. So I had the credentials, and I had the good wishes of both senators and a Democratic president, and there was a little flurry of other people who were interested, but it didn't get anywhere.
Now, of course, by then you had affiliated with another law firm, or had you stayed solo after Judge Reeves left for the bench?
I stayed solo until for briefly, and then Judge Hobbs and I grew up together.
In Selma?
In Selma. And he was with the White Bradley firm in Birmingham, and was there a rising star. And I went up to Birmingham and talked him into coming down and joining me. And just as soon as Judge Reeves left, Truman came down and we formed Godbold and Hobbs.
All right. So Judge Truman Hobbs, who, of course, was appointed to the bench, I believe, in 1980, to the district court bench.
That's right.
And you were childhood friends in Selma. Did you attend the same schools?
No. I was on one side of the blue-collar line, and he was on the other.
And I believe, if I'm correct, Judge Hobbs went to Yale when you went to Harvard.
Yes, yes.
All right.
We were, interestingly, we graduated at the same time. We both applied to Justice Black for clerkship, and Truman got it. And as it turned out, it suited me better what I did, but we competed for it, and he was selected by Black because, you know, his father was congressman then, and it was Congressman Hobbs, and that was a natural result. I'll have to tell you an interesting story about leaving the law practice with Judge Reeves. He just said, let's sit down, let's talk about finances. He said, when I leave, you're going to have some matters that you finished up on which you won't be paid until then, on which I've done some work, and y'all just send me a check for whatever you think my work's worth. And I said, that suited me fine. And I said, now, if you know there are established formulas, differing formulas about how you value a law practice as a going business, how are we going to do that? Which just means it's an intrinsic value as a business rather than how many fees are coming. I said, how do we value that? He said, we don't. It's yours.
In 1951. He did not have to start.
He walked out and said, pay me what I've already earned and nothing else. And I said, when can we pay you? There's something you earned, when it comes in, we'll send you a check. But how about books and furniture and so on? They are yours. And he said, well, I would like to be paid for those. Pay for them when you can.
That helped you tremendously, I'm sure, didn't it?
Yeah, but I inherited a going business, which is simply not done.
You inherited also his goodwill.
Yep. Yeah. Yep. Yeah. Yep.
As you look back on your 3 years with Judge Reeves, I know that he taught you much about the law, and you've referred to that. But you mentioned also that he taught you a lot about life and about human beings. You referred, for example, to his own conscience for equality of the races. I wish you would share with us a little bit more about what Judge Reeves, the man, taught you, as opposed to Judge Reeves, the lawyer. And I'm sure much of it was by example, and much might have been more affirmative by instruction.
Well, it was mostly by watching him, I guess. I saw and understood and sympathized with his emerging feeling about race relations. This was an emerging feeling, like most people of his generation. This was just a fact of life that I guess he never did worry about. I don't know, but I could see this developing, and it was developing in my part, on my part. And I saw his dealing with other lawyers candidly, straightforwardly, courteously. I would have been much more brash than he would be, much tougher on an adversary than he would be. And I learned that his was the best way. And you know yourself that lawyers build a not just a reputation, but a spirit within themselves of the way to do things, and that communicates to others. And he had this talent of communicating to others. Without preaching, they just saw the way to do it. They just saw the way that a lawyer does it, and that a gentleman does it, and that a Christian does it. And
that style made him popular even in the late 40s in Montgomery, Alabama?
In Montgomery, Alabama. Now, yes, yes. Now, he didn't roll over and play dead. But he knew how to be tough in a nice way. And so interesting. When I was with him, it must have been the election of 1950 when we had one heck of a fight between the Democrats and the Dixiecrats. He was the chief voice of the Democrats in the state. Wallace Malone of Dothan was the chief voice of the Dixiecrats and had invested a great deal of money with them. We managed to hold the Dixiecrats off, and within a month, Wallace Malone was in our office and said, "Dick, I want you to represent me in this matter in which my bank is in trouble." And they'd been political adversaries in the strongest sense, and within a month, Malone was there hiring him as his lawyer. And he just had the wonderful knack of understanding human beings.
Communicated well.
Oh, communicated it well, and inspiring confidence in people. And I watched him tell a sheriff who was his client, charged with beating a child. He got tired of his peeping through the crack in the lady's dressing room at the swimming pool, and the third offense, he paddled him and got indicted for it. And he came in to talk to us. Judge Reeves undertook his defense, and he said, "Judge, we haven't got the problem. I got two deputies who'll testify. I wasn't even there." And the judge said, "We can't do that." And he gently explained why, that he couldn't be a party to a known untruth. sheriff hesitated, and Judge Reeves said, go home and think about it overnight and talk to your wife. He came back the next morning and said, we talked and we prayed, and I did it, and I'm going to plead guilty. Hmm. And the judge said, I believe I can help you. He went over and sat down and told Judge Kenema the whole story. And Judge Kenema said, I'll give him the lightest sentence I can give him and put him on probation. Well, there aren't many people who could bring that off.
What was it that molded and made Judge Reeves the character that he was?
I don't know. I don't know what did it. He didn't have it with his own parents. I don't know anything about them. But somehow the lightning struck. And as I say, his belief in the racial field got stronger and stronger and stronger until he was right at the cutting edge.
And Judge, that's particularly of interest to me because I have always believed that it was so difficult for lawyers in the Deep South to be on the cutting edge at a time when membership in the Klan was tacitly expected, or membership in the White Citizens Council. Segregation was the way of life. There were, my recollection, in the 50s, I was born in 1950, there may have been two or three black lawyers in the area, but not many. And I'm just fascinated by the notion that a lawyer in Montgomery in that era could stand tall and stand for the right principles. And the only contemporary I can recall is Clifford Durr. Was he a contemporary of Judge
Reeves?
Yes,
yes indeed. Yes, indeed. And also a very, very strong man who suffered greatly for his beliefs. In fact, he was over conferring with Colonel Reeves once in a while, and they shared the views about the particular lawsuits, I suspect, but they were not, I don't think they were ever in a case together. Durr was more of a firebrand, and I don't mean that as criticism. It was hard to be a firebrand. Judge Reeves' approach was quieter, and just felt in quite a ways. He wasn't hiding, but he just wasn't in any firebrand litigation that I can remember. That's a political litigation, but it was hard to stand up, not for me, but Judge Reeves finally left his church. His daughter had been married there. His son had been buried from there.
Would you tell us the name of the church?
Trinity Presbyterian Church. He'd been a steward or a deacon or whatever they call him in the church there. And people would come in and wouldn't sit in the same pew with him.
Is this after he became a federal judge, or yeah, while he was a lawyer?
While he was a federal judge. And he would go in and sit in a pew, and people would get up and move. And finally, on a particular Sunday, the church learned that the number varied, but the usual number stated was four black people were coming and going to come into the church for services, and the ushers were not to let them in. And when that happened, he went to the minister and told him he was leaving. And he affiliated with another church.
That was probably in the 1960s?
I suspect that's about right. Mm. Maybe early, I'm not sure. And you know that the newspaper was on him all the time and eventually wrote an editorial saying that they couldn't get rid of him, but that he shouldn't be buried on Alabama soil.
And the Montgomery Advertiser?
The Journal, that's when the Journal was still operating.
The Alabama Journal.
And people threw garbage all over his son's grave.
Now, we don't have the privilege of interviewing Judge Reeves, so you're the closest that we have. And, Judge, that's why I want to linger a little bit with this, because Judge Reeves mattered so much for not only the state of Alabama, but for the nation, and indirectly because he was your mentor. The Middle District has certainly benefited so much from his principles and his stands. So before I go back to your law practice with Judge Hobbs after Judge Reeves became a judge, I'm going to indulge the time I have with you just a little bit for you to share with me your recollections of Judge Reeves' transition to the federal bench and the times and circumstances which brought him so much castigation when he'd been such a beloved lawyer. And of course, we're getting into that era when the civil rights movement was getting underway. We're getting closer and closer to the Montgomery bus boycott. And I assume that he was on a number of the three judge panels, which had very unpopular decisions that led to changes from a segregated society. Am I correct?
That is surely right. Well, even as early as when I joined him, one could see his conscience troubling, and sometimes his what he said and his feeling about anybody who was mistreated or any incident of mistreatment. And one interesting little factor is when I practiced with him and later with Judge Hobbs, that we had one waiting room. Nearly all the law firms in Montgomery had two waiting rooms.
As did all the waiting rooms for doctors.
That's
and
right.
Professionals.
I just never had thought of it with respect to lawyers, but I encountered it when I got here.
Judge Reeves always had one waiting
room. After he opened his own office. Now, when he was with his old firm, I'm confident, I assume that's not so, but he always had one. We had one waiting room.
And Judge Reeves saw black clients, am I correct?
Oh, yes, we had lots of black clients.
And am I correct in my recollection that in 1948-49, the only black lawyer I can recall possibly in practice is Mahala Ashley Dickerson, who is, I believe, was the first African-American woman to practice
right.
law here.
I think that's right.
My history does not reveal any black lawyer at that time. I don't think Fred Gray had returned.
Fred Gray was not here.
Solomon Say,
the other man who was in the legislature from here.
Charles Langford.
Yeah, Charles had got his passed the bar exam after I got here. The reason I know that is that in that time you had to get, the applicant had to get affidavits from two lawyers showing long acquaintance and then favorable characteristics. Mr. Fred Whiting, who I suspect had reasons for his views, made an affidavit because Charles Langford's mother worked for him. Or it was his client, I don't know which. But anyhow, I did not know Mr. Whiting well, but he called me and asked me if I would make a second affidavit. And I said, I don't know him. But if you will get me acquainted with him, I'll make a second affidavit. So I did get acquainted with him and took enough time for life to pass and made a second affidavit. And the Secretary of the State Bar called me and asked me to withdraw it. And I told him, nope. And so he got qualified for the bar exam and passed it and became a lawyer.
The secretary of the Alabama State Bar asked you to withdraw your affidavit?
He said he thought I didn't know him well enough. I said, well, I've stated it as fairly as I can, and that's it.
Did you suffer any punishment for that?
No, I did not. Mm-hmm. I did not.
So Judge Reeves set the standard, and that just made you think nothing of having one waiting room for black clients
no.
and white clients.
Gosh, I never thought of it as a matter of any consequence.
And obviously Judge Hobbs shared your views as well.
Oh, yes, yes, indeed.
So Judge Reeves had been able, as a lawyer, to stand fast on his principles and not suffer much castigation from the bar, I suppose because he was revered just as a great lawyer?
That's not quite right.
All right.
He was not a very social person in the society sense.
Not the country club type?
He didn't care much for the country club business. He didn't even belong to the country club. And he didn't care much for social activity. And so he eschewed social activity. He didn't seek it. And so when it didn't occur, I guess he didn't worry about it. And the Bar Association here did not give him support after he was under high criticism. And he'd pretty well divorced himself from the Bar Association. I mean, he didn't do anything ugly or resign or anything. He just didn't have anything to do with them. I took a little different approach on that. I recognized that I would get some flack, but I concluded they weren't going to run me off. And I went to every bar thing that there was. And maintained the same social life I had maintained. I was never really the subject of anything ugly on a social occasion but one time.
Tell me about that, Judge.
Well, he was a lawyer, a small office lawyer. And at a barbecue, he got cranked up and said something ugly to me. And I just let it go. And the next morning, he apologized. Mm. So it is not quite accurate to say that society forced Judge Reeves out. He really never was in, mm-hmm. except in a social sense. And he just didn't like that sort of thing. He didn't like it. It was uncomfortable, a cocktail party. And my approach just was different one, and my approach worked out all right.
How soon after assuming his federal judgeship did Judge Reeves begin to experience the approbation of the bar or the society in Montgomery, or I should say the community in Montgomery? He became, he was appointed in 1951, if I recall.
I can't place it as time, Dolores. I cannot.
But do you recall any decisions that were so unpopular that the advertiser began to decry in editorials?
Oh, the advertiser didn't so much, the journal did.
The
but
journal.
They were, I can't tell you when those decisions came. Of course, the bus boycott was very strong, had lots of consequences. Beyond that, I can't tie case mm-hmm. to case. It was just a community attitude. On one case, and I don't remember what it was, which case it was, there was a great deal of local criticism. And I talked to the president of the bar and said, look, the bar ought to come to Judge Reeves' defense. He's done what he's supposed to do. And he's done it in thoughtful language, and there's nothing aggressive about it. He's just decided to write principle. And I had a good incident to go by because they had this Baldwin County a few months before, and the newspaper down there had risen up in defense of the judge. And the bar had said, y'all ought to be offering Judge Reeves a explaining to the community that he's done exactly what he's supposed to. He said, well, he never has asked me. Mm. I said, he's not supposed to ask you. You're supposed to decide that. And he said, did he need to see me? And I said, nope. He said, well, you tell him if he would ask us, we probably could respond. I said, he's not going to ask you to defend him. That's your responsibility. And then no defense ever came. No defense ever came.
I gather that you and Judge Reeves remained good friends even after
he was
appointed.
Oh, yes.
I want to focus now on your law practice after Judge Reeves became a judge. You and Judge Hobbs, you persuaded him to come down from Birmingham where he'd been practicing. And, of course, had the benefit of the practice you'd established with Judge Reeves. Tell me about the years that you and Judge Hobbs spent together and whether any other lawyers joined you immediately.
Well, we were together until I went on the bench, which was...
Until 1966?
Yeah.
You and Judge Hobbs?
Yes. And we had a very, very good practice. In fact, I've often said that it may have been bigger firms now. Nobody had any more fun practice law than we did.
Made fun. Well, that was not a fun era, was it?
Well, he was. We had a lot of the same principles and easy relationship. It was just great. And because he's a magnificent trial lawyer, too. He's the best trial lawyer of his time. At least around Montgomery, I won't say right, but around Montgomery South, he was the best trial lawyer around. He had some credit to Judge Reeves. He walked on the court, and in 5 minutes, a jury would know him. Tall and handsome, and this wonderful, easy personality. We had a case in Lawrence, Alabama, some years ago. Hard-fought case, and local jury of farmers, and so on. And when it was over, one old gentleman in overalls came over and over and said, I was a major lawyer, but we should come down and run superintendent of education. He was a great and successful practice. One of our great friends is Weldon.
Weldon?
Weldon. He's in the retorts textbook now. And we had a case in which a woman who was later executed poisoned a little child, took out insurance on the child's life and herself as a beneficiary, and then killed the child. And three insurance companies did this, and he sued for wrongful death. And they see policy proceeds. They want policy proceeds. He sued for wrongful death. And goes, question, is everything caused? Independent of anything caused. And he said, they can't have any application when the evening house is very wanted to us and for this. And guess who won? And the Supreme Court won that.
That was landmark.
It was landmark, and it had a second effect because they have an unofficial ceiling on death penalty cases, death, wrongful death cases. A wrongful death case in Montgomery County, this people think with ordinarily was $15,000. That was ordinary value of human life. And it was written in stone, but it's what you could expect.
Regardless of their
occupation,
that mattered.
Punitive damage of the day is supposed to think was all this. And when Jerry was explaining that to me, I said, that can't be true. you know that it is. And we got some $5,000, which was big money in that kid time. And we got a pretty powerful funds, lived in National, second big company in Birmingham, and I've gotten it in a hospital about 4 years. And then had some other good cases too. We were fortunate to tried one of the early helicopter crash cases from the fort down south, and then we became the experts in that, and we tried lots of helicopter cases.
Fort Rucker?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And we just had good dental practice.
Did you find yourself gravitating at all federal practice?
No.
So both of you
good
just
case
enjoyed.
That came to the door, we did get. Now, we did do this. A lot of lawyers did practice in the federal court, and they were never comfortable, and often not at ease because they didn't know the rules. Thursday night on, we were going to become familiar with the rules, all of them. We knew federal rules back and forward, and that was a great help to us. One time, the clerk of court called, and said, we got a problem with the federal rule. We can't tell what so-and-so means. Can you help? He said, sure. So we pitched in and told the collector that's what it was. Wasn't our case, but
you had lots of lawyers referring cases to you.
Lots of lawyers asking us questions, but Albert Copeland joined us after several years. Albert also was a fine lawyer, a splendid lawyer. There was a complicated case with a million facts. We had a big bankruptcy here of a New York Stock Exchange company, and he had a million facts, and he worked with it for 2 or 3 years, and he was great. He could try a fact case and just have it perfectly. And he died 10, 15 years later, I guess. Then we began to pick up our lawyers. When I left the firm, I had 9, I believe.
In 1966?
Yeah.
Right. I want to go back a little bit to the period of your practice between 51 and 66. You've alluded to lots of the events of the time, which really were born right here in Montgomery, bus boycott with Rosa Parks, and of course, there were pivotal events like the Freedom Riders, bus ride, all of these things happening before you got on the bench. The church bombing in Birmingham, I believe, I think even the Selma to Montgomery march. As a lawyer, and I should say as a lawyer, because you and Judge Hobbs were together for most of that time, how did you manage, if you did manage, to avoid getting involved in, on one side or another of those big civil rights disputes?
We were asked, and now we were. Most people don't know it, but we were the lawyers for the bus company. After the
boycott?
Well, when the boycott was developing, the bus company's lawyer withdrew and would not represent them anymore. And they had no lawyer. And the bus company's desire was to keep the bus running. You see, the city ordinance required seating. And the city said, you see the way the ordinance says, oh, the buses don't run. And so the bus company came to see us and said, asked us to represent them and said, what's your position on this? And they said, we'd look for the city to turn us loose. The minute they turn us loose, the bus will go. But the city said, no, sir. So you run those buses and we'll stop every one of them. So we were in Buckhanna, same a lot of people didn't know it. And the opposite is always clear.
When we resume, I want to focus on how those other events in Alabama affected you and your practice. And in particular, I want to talk about the strong governors that we had between 51 and 66. Governor Patterson, Governor Folsom, Governor Wallace, and not in that order, but I'm interested, particularly since Judge Reeves had been your mentor, and particularly since you came into your practice with such a strong sense of right and wrong. Judge, I have been recounting some of the crucial milestones for what could only be described as the foundation for the civil rights laws that ultimately emerged in the 1970s. And recalling that while you and Judge Hobbs were in law practice between 1951 and 1966, much of that foundation was established right here in Montgomery and then across the state of Alabama. Now, I recognize that your subsequent judicial decisions on some of these matters will make it impossible for you to share your perspectives on them at the time. But I would like for you just to share with us your own reactions to and recollections of the Alabama that was between 1951 and 1966 and how it affected your practice as a lawyer or your development as a human being. Just any recollections that you have about that time.
Well, that's a long stretch of time, a long time ago. We were doing a general practice. Tried not to do divorce and domestic relations cases. We represented white clients and we represented black clients. I can think of interesting black cases for blacks. One wonderful one was a large, big, muscular woman named Nellie Jones who worked at the railroad shops. And had left her home about 2 o'clock in the morning and had fallen over a crack in the sidewalk and hurt herself badly. The defense tried to make out that she was out prowling around at night. And they said, oh no, said the river was rising and the police came by and told us to leave home. Well, if the lawyer had been smart, he would have let her alone because she got the better of that dialogue. He said, well, take a little nip of liquor once in a while? And she said, sure do. And he said, as a matter of fact, you had some that night. He said, yep. He held up the bottle, said, how much? She said, about that much. He said, oh, Lily, you weigh 220 pounds. You didn't have a little old drink of liquor like that. She said, that was all there was. Well, she had destroyed him by then. But he didn't stop. He said, you also sold vegetables door to door, didn't you? Yes, sir. You're trying to tell this jury, I hate that phrase, you're trying to tell this jury, that you quit pushing your push cart around to sell vegetables because you got hurt in this accident? I said, oh, no, said the A&P come in and said they could sell them cheap and I could buy them. At a little recess, and Judge Carter was laughing at all this. He told the defense lawyer, he said, next time you get hurt, I think you better hire Nellie.
Judge Eugene Carter from the Montgomery County
Judge
Circuit
Carter.
Court.
And, gosh, I wish I could remember cases, but I can't. I know that, it just didn't make any difference in my office. Did you have a good case? Are you telling us the truth? And so on. Fine, let's go.
My general impression is that you had fun as a lawyer.
Oh, we did. We had more fun. Our office shared lots of experiences about cases. And if I was working on a case, I'd walk down the hall and talk to one of the other lawyers. If I was writing a brief, I'd let somebody else look at the brief. And we had a lot of fun about the fact that at one time one of the associates found in a file Judge Hobbs' Yale transcript. It revealed that he had had a course called River Valley Law.
River Valley Law?
He never would tell us what it was. And there was a joke in the family, if you had a question you couldn't find the answer to, ask the man who probably had it in River Valley Law. Well, 15 years later, a young student came in to see me from Yale without an appointment. I think he'd been to see Frank Johnson and just was catching me while in town. Yale, and we talked some about his experience. He was very diffident. I just had to pull information out of him. And I finally told him about River Valley Law. Well, it said worth at least a smile. He never changed expression. I said, did you have the course in River Valley Law? He said, no, sir, but I had a great course in African tribal law. I called Judge Hobbs and said, Truman, I hate to tell you, Yale's back at it. sure.
You were practicing, you mentioned Judge Johnson, and that reminds me that your law practice was during the period that Judge Johnson came here to be a federal district court judge. Do you recall who was a federal judge before Judge Johnson?
Kenema. Judge Kenema, K-E-N-N-A-M-E-R.
Right.
He was a small town lawyer from North Alabama, a conservative Republican appointee, but a good, solid judge, quiet, not an academic, a very pragmatic judge. And he was quiet, he ran a good court, he treated the lawyers well. It was, he was good. He was different in the fact that he had his son for his law clerk.
He did.
Which was unusual.
Did Judge Johnson replace him?
Yes. There was a battle over that seat. Judge Johnson was U.S. attorney in the Northern District of Alabama. And Judge Johnson was the potential nominee of the sort of old-time Republicans, because his family had been Republicans forever. And T.B. Hill from Montgomery was the potential nominee for the Dixiecrat Republicans, the people who just joined up. And there was a battle that I don't know the details of. But an interesting feature of it was a lot of the Democrats got in the battle on behalf of Judge Johnson. And there was a rumor, whether true or not, that the Alabama Bar Convention was going to adopt a resolution favoring T.B. Hill. And the leadership in the Democratic Party rounded up all the young Democrat lawyers in Alabama they could get that could go, and they went down to Mobile to be sure the resolution didn't pass, and it did not. Mm. And Judge Johnson was appointed. And, of course, it was controversial because he was from outside the district. And one side had a new Republican and the other side had a Republican from outside the district. And
did you have occasion to practice law before Judge Johnson?
Yes, I have all the scars to show you for it. he was tough, Dolores, as you well know. He was fair, but he was tough, and he kept the lawyers on the edge of their seats all of the time. Everybody was a little bit scared of him. And he ran a tight, tight ship here. The only time he really got on me was he said I was showing by the expression on my face that I didn't like his ruling.
You didn't do that, did you, Judge?
I said, Judge, it's hard for me to conceal dismay. He said, I don't mind the dismay. I don't mind dismay. It's the do something of it.
Disdain, maybe?
Yeah, disdain or something like that of it. And he cured me. I tried a long, long case in front of him, the only antitrust case I had.
Actually tried an antitrust case?
Sure did.
I always thought antitrust just belonged in the law school textbooks.
Involving the a piece of railroad equipment and as to manufactured by Cushell here. And I had 100 and something pre-marked exhibits. The numbers were already on them. All I had to do was offer them. Non-jury. Albert Copeland was sitting there feeding them to me as fast as I could put them in, and Judge Johnson got on me and said I wasn't moving fast enough. And I'll tell you one other Johnson story, and then I'm going to stop. There was a case involving, it was familiar with the local U.S. attorney, but the Justice Department sent a senior attorney down from Washington to argue it, and he didn't really know anything about the case. And he got along a little bit in his argument, and Judge Johnson pressed him so hard that he fainted. And the U.S. attorney picked him up by the head, and somebody else picked him up, Bailey picked him up by the feet, and they started to tote him out of the bathroom, out of the room, and Judge Johnson told the U.S. attorney, said, put his head down, let somebody else do that, and go on with the argument. He used to say, that wasn't so. I said, it is so, too. You just don't like the story.
Was Judge Dement the U.S. attorney back then?
No, he came later.
Came later.
Yeah.
All right. You certainly practiced law at a time when this state was producing just numerous lawyers who would qualify for the pantheon of greats, either because of their innate ability or because of their colorful character. Are there some that you can recall now that you have fond memories of your affiliations with? Or
Francis Hare was a splendid
Francis
lawyer,
Hare.
Largely a plaintiff's lawyer. He was like Judge Reeves. He was appealing. He was in a different sort of way, but juries liked him. And he had a wonderful capacity for phrases that would be communicated. I saw him in a trial. He represented plaintiff, the defendants. Defense was the plaintiff was badly hurt. And they said, well, he was only 80% hurt. Francis Hare said he was 100% disabled for life. Well, they got to the argument to the jury, and Francis pulled out his watch. Said, any of you fellows on the jury want to buy this watch? Says it'll tell time 80% of the time. And he, just this wonderful phrase, I sat on a case in which question of the speed of the train through town, and of course, you know how it was. The engineer crew said they were barely moving, and the other people said they were going real 90 miles an hour. Francis Hare had the testimony of a little old lady who was standing in the kitchen washing dishes when the train came by. And our panel asked Judge Thornberry, asked him some questions about it, and Judge Thornberry had never seen Francis Hare before. And Judge Thornberry said, how can she judged a train coming through there, speed of a train, and said she only saw it for about 2 seconds. And Francis said, well, if you're going 90 miles an hour, you can't see it but 2 seconds. Well, of course, that's a total non sequitur. That didn't prove anything. But we got in conference, and Thornberry said, that's a great judge. I mean, that's a great lawyer that explained that to me.
Francis Hare. Of course, he's the founder of the Hare Wynn firm in Birmingham.
Indeed.
Or was it his father?
No, that was Francis.
That was the Francis Hare.
He was a great plaintiff's lawyer. Another great plaintiff's and defense criminal lawyer was Roderick Beddoe in Birmingham. B-E-D-D-O-W. He was Judge Reeves Bettage, and he'd been mostly, I guess, a criminal lawyer. I had to, when Judge Reeves and I were practicing together, some question came up, and he couldn't try a case in Troy, and I had to go down and try it. I had Roderick Beto on the other side, and Roderick Beto sent the whole trial giving me a fatherly pat on the head. And he got down to the jury argument at the end, and he again referred to that, said, "This is a nice young man from Montgomery. I've been so glad to try this case with him. Said, one of these days, he's going to be a good lawyer." Trying to think of other things. So many wonderful things happened. Oh, well, one more on Judge Reeves. We were trying a case, and I better not identify the lawyer on the other side because he's a local vintage. And we represented the defendant. The other lawyer rose to make his initial presentation to the jury, and he fixed his sleeves, his French cuff sleeves, and he fixed the cheek. His college keys that were on the chain across here, got himself all arranged and went over and took the jury's pitcher of water and poured himself a glass of water, which I wouldn't dare do, and set it down and then drank the whole glass and then got ready to speak to the jury. And in a whisper you could hear all over the courtroom, Judge Reeves leaned over to me and said, "You're now going to see a windmill powered by water." And there was nothing the lawyer could do. You can't respond to something like that. You just make it worse.
Judge, I suspect you had your own techniques, having been mentored by Judge Reeves and having witnessed all these other trial lawyers. I don't want to embarrass you, but I have heard that you were a pretty good trial lawyer yourself. What do you consider your strengths and as a lawyer? What were your, without telling me your secrets, what did you consider your strong points as a trial lawyer?
Well, I did a lot of trials, but particularly in the early years of my practice. But as time went on and my firm grew larger, and Judge Hobbs was doing a lot of trials, he's a better trial lawyer than I was by far. And so I began to pull out of that a little bit, and he began to handle more of them. So, and in the later years, I was doing a good bit of administration of the firm, mm-hmm. and responsible for management and policy and so forth. He's a better trial lawyer, but I could get along, but in most circumstances, he was better, and so with the real blockbusters in the latter years, he did.
Did you do any appellate work either at the state or federal level when you were a lawyer?
Oh, gosh, I went to the Alabama Supreme Court lots of times, and I went to the Old Fifth Circuit a few times.
Did you enjoy that kind of advocacy at the appellate level?
I sure did. I liked that. And the Fifth Circuit was always very exciting. And
it was based in New Orleans back then, wasn't it?
Yeah, based in New Orleans. Mm-hmm. I argued a case against Francis Hale mm-hmm. in New Orleans. Francis was the appellant, and you then got 30 minutes to decide. He got 48 minutes.
How did he manage that?
He just had that short court charmed. And old Judge Hutchison was then the chief judge, and Francis had him hypnotized. And Francis sat down, and Judge Hutchison said, "Well, that lawyer took 8 minutes. Counsel, you got 12 minutes." And I protested mildly, and he just said, "You got 12 minutes." So I sat down, and as I went out of the room, still just boiling mad, you remember the name Marion Reston, who was a great Montgomery lawyer.
Yes. He
was in the audience, and he saw how angry I was. And as I went out, he came and put his arm around my shoulder and said, "Don't worry about it. They didn't give you but 12 minutes. That means you won the case. They couldn't sustain it otherwise."
But did you actually win?
I did.
Fantastic.
But Francis had talked him out of 48 of the 60 minutes.
while you were practicing law with Judge Hobbs, did you ever envision yourself as a trial judge?
No.
Never even had aspirations?
I did not. I will tell you how I got into it is I was ill at home with a minor problem of some kind. And Judge Reeves came to see me just out of the blue. Said, would you be interested in going on the Court of Appeals? And I said, well, Judge, let me think about that a week. Talked to my wife and think about it a week. And came back and said, yes, I'd be interested. And he said, all right, I'm going to help you all I can. Let's go for it. And so he, his voice was very helpful in the matter.
Tell us a little bit about the process. This was July 22, 1966, when you were first appointed to the U.S. Court of Appeals for the Fifth Circuit. But share with us the background. After Judge Reeves basically said to you, if you want it, I will help you get it. What was the process like, the investigation and the Senate involvement?
Well, the first thing I did was go to see my two senators.
Who were Senators Hill and Sparkman.
And I had worked for them and for the Democratic Party for 12 years. And moreover, I'd been chairman of the Stevenson-Sparkman campaign in Alabama when he ran for vice president. So both of them were my friends, and I have their friends, and I'd done a lot of other things. And when both of them talked encouragingly, but without committing anything, but talk encouragingly, then I gave them wrote formal letters explaining them I would be interested in, so on. And then I talked to people that might have some influence with them and just moved along. And the FBI investigated. I had one interesting experience with that. A woman I did not know from the Montgomery Black community called me about 1 o'clock in the morning and said the FBI people had been by to see her, asking her about me, and she said, I don't know you. And I told them I didn't know you, but to come back. I said, how can I find out something about you? I said, well, you call this person and this person and this person, and whatever they tell you, you can rely on. Rufus Lewis was a great friend of mine, and I sent, Rufus was one of them I sent her to talk to. And
for the record here, Rufus Lewis became the first United States Marshal here for the Middle District of Alabama.
Who was first black head marshal.
Right.
Yeah.
First black, I'm sorry, and he, of course, was very instrumental in the voting rights and civil rights struggle here in Montgomery.
He was first class. First jury case I had when I came here to practice was for the Ross Clayton Funeral Home. That's where I came to know him. And then from then on, we were friends in nearly every political campaign. I was talking with him about saying, look, you can help us with the black community, and what can I do to help y'all, and so on. He was a good, strong voice in the black community for my crowd.
So the FBI investigation surely didn't find any negatives in the black community.
I didn't hear of it. I'm sure they didn't. The FBI also, to show you how thorough the examination was, I had a phone call from Charles Edwards, who was a registrar at Auburn. And I had worked in his office in 1936 and 1937. And in 1966, the FBI went to see him and said we wouldn't want to talk to him about me. And I had a representation that I thought there was no problem with it. I represented all the white officials in Lowndes County who were charged in some sort of conspiracy against some black voters. But it turned out there wasn't a dying thing from the case. For the case, a three-judge district court with Judge Reeves on it dismissed it from the bench. But I had represented the white officials. And some people in North Alabama who wanted somebody else to be appointed wrote to Justice Department. And he said I'd been representing whites down there in a suit by blacks, and they ought to take notice of that. Mm. And Senator Hill said, you better respond to this. So I told him, wrote him and told him of my representation of a black kid down in Lowndes County who was about to be shipped off for 20 years for insulting. He was drunk and he got off the bus and insulted a young white woman that he met on the sidewalk immediately. And they were going to put him away for 20 years. And I wore out a set of tires going down there to persuade them that wasn't going to do that county any good to do that sort of thing. And then slap him on the wrist and let him go. And after about 6 months, a solicitor who really is a pretty decent guy, and I said, all right, I'm tired of you coming down here and asking me. I said, give him a $25 fine and let him go and tell him don't ever come back down here. He was just passing through on the bus.
They kept him in jail all that time?
Yeah, but I was anxious that they kept him in jail. If they tried him, he was gone. Mm. And because he was sort of building up credit for time served, and the family of the woman who he had insulted were getting tired of it. And of course, I had the best practice there was down in Lowndes County. And my lawyer contacts down there said, you represent this boy and you'll never win another case in Lowndes County. And Truman and I talked about it and we said, the hell, we're going to represent him. And we did and never had a problem. Mm. But one interesting offshoot of that was that some of the national power structure in the black community wanted him to be tried and be a 20-year martyr. And I said, man, you're going to try this case over my dead body, we're not going to try him because he's gone. We're going to stay with it and work with it and talk with people and work with it, and finally the solicitor said, okay, I give up. So I had to explain all that to the Justice Department after they questioned the fact that I'd represented white officials from down there.
Did that resolve those questions?
Well, it was the last I heard of it, so. Mm-hmm.
Was there any formal opposition to your appointment? Did you have to go, I suppose you did, did you testify before the Senate, the Judiciary Committee?
Yes, it was a much easier proposition then. Each senator, and there must have been six or seven there, had in front of him a folder about this thick with some markers in it. And I knew that every one of them had somebody tell him what to look at. He hadn't read it all. And the chairman from Mississippi, Eastlands, asked me if I had read it. I said I had. He said, is there anything you want to correct in it or change? I said, no, I'd been crazy to do that. I said, no, sir. He said, well, does anybody else have any questions? Well, I did not know it, but Eastland had gone to University of Alabama Law School for a year, and then he went back to Mississippi and graduated over there.
Senator Eastland?
Yes. And, of course, Eastland probably didn't agree with me about anything, though he was being very courteous and pleasant. He said, well, if nobody else has any questions, the chairman has one. And I thought, oh, gosh, what have they found out about? He's going to embarrass me about something. He said, I think the committee is entitled to an explanation of why a reasonably intelligent young man from Alabama would turn his back on his state law school and go up north to Harvard. Well, the committee all burst out laughing, and that was the end of it.
Breathed a sigh of relief.
That was the only problem I had.
So but it was a relatively smooth process for you.
Yeah, and it took only a few minutes, and of course, Senator Sparkman and Senator Hill had been there and had told him that I was the greatest lawyer since Abraham Lincoln. That sort of business. But that was the end of it.
It was President Johnson who actually nominated you. Did you ever meet him? Did you ever have occasion to meet him?
Briefly. He came through here in his last campaign in a wonderfully thought out train trip. On a train through Alabama, and it stopped at every little station where there was not little, but any substantial station. And the local people would arrange for all the local Democratic leaders to be there waiting on the train. The people on the train got off, and the locals got on, and then they had a bus there to take the departing passengers back home. Went down 50 miles to the next station and repeated the process. And I was one of those asked to ride on the train, and I met him and chatted with him briefly then. An interesting story that relates to Homer Thornberry, who was on the Fifth Circuit with me, and who was a magnificent man. He was never practiced law when he was appointed to the Fifth Circuit, and he worked like a demon on every case. Just a wonderful person.
Had he come directly from being a law professor?
He was a politician in Texas. He was one of LBJ's best friends. And someone asked him one night when some of us were together having a cocktail, paraphrasing, said, look, all of President Johnson's antecedents are that he's racially biased. He has nothing in favor of the black community. And he said, Johnson looked the guy in the eye and said, we've mistreated black people in this country for 100 years, and I'm going to do something about it. Mm. And he said, the result was the Civil Rights Bill of 1964, which of course was a great piece of legislation. And Homer Thornberry said, I was sitting there when his day of decision was made. He said, from then on, everything was all straightened out.
Was it really even more special that you were nominated by President Johnson?
Well, I admired him. He was an octagonal character, and you might hit one of the wrong facets, but my gosh, he was he knew how to get things done, and he didn't always do them politely, and he didn't always do them considerately. He could be mean and ugly and underhanded, and then do something for you so nice that you just couldn't believe it. Mm. One of his top aides, who had make a speech talking about his time in the White House, he had a room in the White House, stayed there, and he said about 11 o'clock one night, the president called him to come to his room, and he said as he went in, the president was disrobing. The president said, hand me my pajamas off the door there. He handed them to him. Well, the head of the National Security Council then was Mac somebody, I can't remember the name. Said the president said, now go fire Mac Innes. Well, this is like firing the vice president, and but he said, I had my orders. And he said, I went down the hall and I tapped on the man's door real gently to be sure he didn't wake up. And then the next morning, he saw the president and said, did you fire Mac Innes? He said, no, sir, he was asleep. He said, that's all that's ever been said about it. He said, he was giving me a one-sentence order about one of the most important officials in the country, and it never came to pass, so it's the end of it. Mm. And he said the next day he would do something so earth-shaking and great that it would make you hold your breath.
Quite a legend.
Quite a legend, and a great, in his way, a great person.
Judge, did you hesitate at all when Judge Reeves came to you and asked if you were interested in sitting on the federal court?
I had never thought of it. Never considered it. First place, I was younger than most judges, and it simply never occurred to me. And I had a successful law practice and a happy one, and I just said, well, let me think about it and talk to my wife, Judge, and I'll get back to you. And
was Mrs. Godbold encouraging?
Oh, she always has. She said, whatever you want to do is mm-hmm. what we want to do. She was a great support, too. She was a great influence on our court and on the old Fifth Circuit in a very good way. She brought the women and wives together who'd never been considered themselves as having anything to do with it. And she brought them together in a very effective force. Not the decisions on cases, but in getting along and maintaining harmony and repairing the injuries of somebody who was injured. And mm-hmm. she did that magnificently.
And you had an equal role in finessing that humongous Fifth Circuit into some type of collegial atmosphere. How about describing for us the Fifth Circuit that you joined in 1966?
Well, it was then 12 judges. And it was, I suspect, the happiest court, federal court in the country. They worked hard, they had their differences, they stated their views, they had fun together, they had respect for each other. It was a good operation. And the bigger it got, it went from 12 to 13 to 15 to 18 to 23. Mm. And by then it was tough to hold them together. We had not been able to agree on a split. We had our weeks in bank, of in bank cases. Had a big push to cut the time and to adopt a resolution making less than all the judges participate. I wouldn't let any of that come up. And we had a week of in-bank cases with 23 judges, and it was like being run over by a truck. On the last day, Judge Johnson, who had been opposing us, and Judge Goldberg, who had been opposing us, both came out and said, we surrender. That was the last. Well, there was one other facet to it. The holdup at the end, this thing had been kicked around for 20 years, and nobody had ever been able to get it through. The problem at the end was Mississippi would not agree to be aligned with Louisiana and Texas. They wanted to be in the eastern end. They said they had no history, no nothing, no connection, no Louisiana and Texas were oil states and industrial states, and they didn't want anything to do with them. And when it became apparent that that was a permanent bar, Judge Clark and Judge Coleman said, okay, we give up, put us with the West. It was a great gesture for them, but they did it, and then it went on through.
Judge, I'm going to ask you more about that memorable division of the circuit, but I want to go back to your transition and then have you share with me the adjustment from being a lawyer to a federal appellate court. court judge. What was the most difficult part of that transitional period for you? Or what did you miss most about your law practice?
Well, I didn't have a moment of regrets. Suppose my biggest transition was being able to get the casework done. See, a judge was sitting 7 or 8 times a year for a week, and each time he had 20, 22 cases maybe to study, and that kept me very busy and working very hard. There were things in the law that I hadn't had, and I just had to get acquainted with new things. The people on the judges on the court were welcoming, friendly, helpful. We were sitting all the time in New Orleans. Whatever judges were there, it might be 3 or 6 or even the full court several times a year. We almost always had dinner together at night and had fun. And we used to, Daddy and one or two others used to say, when we get all these judges here in the evening, 3, 6, or 9, whatever, get a recorder. Said it's the best conversation in New Orleans and it'll never be heard of. And that's right. There were more good stories, more laughter, and then often go off for dinner together, but we never could agree on recording. But they were wonderfully kind and thoughtful, and I was the youngest circuit judge in America then.
You were 46, right?
I was 46, and most of them 50, 55, 60. And,
no resentment? They didn't treat you any differently?
They didn't treat me anyway, but well. One adjustment I made over a period of time, I thought that I should write a stirring dissent every time I didn't agree with the decision. And it took me a number of years to, and I did it because I wanted it known what I thought and what I thought must be right. And I came to realize that this was often a disservice. First place, nobody really cares too much what the dissenter says, except law teachers. And second, it weakens the decision at least a little bit if you got some reasonable basis for dissenting. And it takes everybody a lot of time waiting around on the dissent to see what they're going to say and so on. And it's not a very healthy practice unless you got something absolutely fundamental and terribly important. And my day of decision came to me when I dissented on an in-bank case and the vote was 15-1 and nobody agreed with me. And I had worked and worked and worked on that, and finally I came to the realization that I'd wasted a lot of time. The only people that helped was law teachers. And I didn't change the result, wasn't going to change the result. Just showed that it was less than unanimous and that John Godbold didn't agree with anybody else.
So thereafter, did you aim only to dissent when you felt very strongly
and
about the
principle? And I had a real good point. And also, I felt there was some opportunity that maybe somewhere down the line the rule might change. Not going to change in this case, but maybe it'd be down the line. And I quit writing dissents because I realized they were creating more harm than good.
Did you have a sense of yourself as a consensus builder on the old Fifth Circuit? Is that something you consciously set out to do? And I mention that because I think that history has accorded you that role.
Well, there were several judges that I, labels are misleading often, but they were sort of centrists. sort of people who tended toward the center. Judge Ainsworth, Judge Charles Clark, Judge Roney, me, Judge Dyer. One time we heard an in-bank case with some strong racial issues in it. The lawyers for the plaintiffs at that table were fiddling with a yellow sheet. And when the argument's over, we always had the bailiff pick up all stray pieces of paper. Well, they left it on the table. And they had a column that said, for us, against us. Down in the middle, it said, can't tell.
Were you in that can't tell?
I was in the can't tell, and Judge Ainsworth and I were, and we loved that. We said, boy, we'd done it right when they can't tell. And I tried to avoid being dug in. That is, trying to keep my mind open. I tried not to conclude the dissent. And I, for certain, didn't go off and reveal anything of my views till I was ready. Now, we had two or three judges. I knew they, what they were going to say before they ever said it. Mm-hmm. But I tried not to do that. Judge Thornberry, who made up for never having been a lawyer by never having practiced, by just being a wonderful scholar. And he used to wait. They would ask, get around to him for his view, and he'd say, let me wait, there's something that bothers me about this. Well, that sent off a light in my tunnel. And when we got all through and everybody else, he said, well, here's what bothers me. And often he was just as right as could be. Mm. He was a great consensus builder. Mm. Judge Simpson was another consensus person. I suppose the media and the law professors probably thought of him as a great liberal, but he was really a very solid centrist person and a wonderful person about which I'm sorry nobody has written a book about him.
Judge Simpson?
Simpson. He had been the most popular state judge in Florida. And then when he came out with a great desegregation opinion, well, that Florida bar turned against him, made his life miserable. It didn't bother him. Wonderful good spirits. He used to, when he was a trial judge for many years, he would have the bailiff bring him a slab of white pine, and he would whittle on it all during the trial. Well, he thought when he got on the Court of Appeals that that would embarrass some of the other judges. So he brought a brand new pencil, and he used to sit by me, and he'd whittle away on that pencil in little tiny little shreds. One day he got on my nerve with it because it started going, you know, how the blackboard will go. And I leaned over after a while and said, cowboy, can you stop whittling on that pencil? He said, you're kind of nervy today, ain't you, J.C.? Which was a Simpson reply. We were hearing I could tell you Simpson stories all day. We were hearing an argument about the development of a piece of land. The defendants who were arguing about the taxes on it made this land way out in the boondocks look like Times Square in New York. It had lights and sidewalks and everything, but they'd never sold a lot. And they got to talking about the benefits of it and so on. And Judge Simpson said, you know, I know this land down there. Have you ever been there? And the New York lawyer said, no, sir. I've had pictures of it and all that. I got all the data on it. Judge Simpson said, well, I can tell you this. When the tractors and date movers arrived down there, the alligators were very surprised. Well, if he had had the sense of the New York lawyer, you wouldn't have pressed it any further. But he kept pressing and pressing and pressing. And Simpson said, counsel, I don't believe you got very good hearing. He said, I grew up right down there in the county where this land is. It is so far out in the country that the sun comes up between it and town. He was wonderful. He was wonderful.
Judge, I get the impression you found another family when you joined the Fifth Circuit.
Yeah, it was a very close group. Some of them not quite as close, but basically a very good, very congenial family, and they tried their best not to let their views about cases interfere.
How was it that you assumed the leadership role so early, being the youngest one on the court, that is the leadership role for getting this burdensome court divided, burdensome because of the number of states and the number of cases?
Well, there were other judges interested in it, and it had sort of died out, though, and because it had been tried twice and had failed, and it had sort of died out, and it took a lot of persuading and waking, and our chief judge, among others, opposed it, and I had to scrap with him about it, and just a lot of good things came together. The Judge Johnson and Judge Reeves also opposed it, and Goldberg and Wisdom were all listened to by the black establishment, which was natural. They were the ones whose views were almost never in question, and the leadership in the black community looked to them, which was the proper place to look, and they didn't want to split, and that held it up.
And for the historical perspective, what was the concern voiced by the established black community about taking these states, Alabama, Georgia, Mississippi, Florida, Texas, and Louisiana, and dividing them?
That concern, fear? Judge Wisdom put in very blunt terms. He said it will create a Magnolia Court in the East. Hmm. It turned out he was 180 degrees wrong. The conservative court came out of the West. But he genuinely thought, that it would ruin the court to create a court of Alabama, Georgia, and Florida, and if maybe Mississippi. He thought it would ruin it. And he made no bones about saying so. He told a committee of Congress that they can't be trusted to enforce the civil rights in the way we've been accustomed to doing it. That was perhaps the harshest thing ever said. Hmm. That we couldn't be trusted, which caused some problems. But that was the great thing. There was a concern that there be a conservative court in the East that would not properly enforce all the constitutional rights that we'd been involved in enforcing. And as I say, they turned out to be 180 degrees wrong.
You became chief judge of the court in the year that the Fifth Circuit ultimately split.
That
you were chief judge February of 1981, and we had the 11th Circuit October.
Yeah.
And you became then only the first person in history to have been chief judge of two circuits.
Yeah, that's been said a lot, but that's just an historical accident. It doesn't have anything to do with merit or anything else.
Well,
it just happened.
I believe you undermined the administrative order that you brought to that process, and it's an order that was recognized perhaps belatedly when you received the highest honor that is given to federal judges, and that's the Edward Devitt Distinguished Service to Justice Award for 1996. I want to focus on that later, but I mention that only because I know from reading so many of the accolades you received during that time that it was your leadership and your administrative stamina that led to the successful division of that circuit. I want to go back a little bit, though, and not overlook some of the important happenings during that first decade. And I'm interested in, because you were yourself a lawyer and you studied under and were mentored by great trial lawyers. I'm interested in your take on the level of appellate advocacy you found at the bar when you joined the circuit and how it evolved over the years. What were the lawyers like who
argued? It's better now than it used to be. It used to be that everybody had 30 minutes because of the press of events. We shortened that to 20 minutes, which, and a lawyer who's really doing it properly can say about as much in 20 minutes as he can say in 30. I always opposed cutting it to 15, but they cut a lot of the cases to 15 now. The advocacy, in my judgment, is better because the bar has learned, and part of it is by preaching from us judges, what the meeting is all about. The meeting is whether it is a dispute resolution meeting. Just takes, happens to take this particular form historically. It's not for the ego of the lawyers. It's not a dramatic performance. It's not a stage action as a lot of lawyers think it is. It's a meeting of people who are trying to communicate with each other and pass information from one to the other and make a decision based on that information. And making too much of oral argument as though it's some sort of magic thing takes people away from the essential nature of the process. And now we say, almost all of us, will you get to the problem? Tell me what happened. Tell me what's wrong with it. And tell me what you want me to do. Well, now, in the old days, people didn't talk like that. They talked often in great crowds of rhetoric about the duties of judges and the provisions of the Constitution, and even had counsel lecture me about abiding by my oath of office, and all sorts of stuff that it makes no difference. And to say, get down to the lick log, and instead get down to the lick log and tell me about it. And do the same thing in your brief. Mm-hmm. It's a lawyer from, a young lawyer who grew up in Montgomery, Roy Nolan Jr., who clerked for Judge Reeves. Splendid lawyer. I saw him walk to the podium in Houston one time, and he said, my name is Roy Nolan from Montgomery, Alabama, and the issue in this case is whether Chambers versus Maroney is retroactive. 20 words, and he had it. Mm-hmm. Had every judge sitting on the edge of his seat, because in one sentence he could tell us exactly what we needed to know, and we could go from there. In the old days of histrionics and arm waving and so on, largely things of the past. Griffin Bell used to have a devastating question. Lawyer would talk for about 2 minutes with some of this flowery sort of stuff, and Bell would say, I hope you got a better argument than that.
And, that would get the lawyer's attention.
Oh, boy, that gets attention. And and briefs are shorter, more directly to the point, less inflammatory, and bad words between lawyers. Are you trying to mislead the court? And you're trying to not state what's correctly in the record and so forth. Well, most of that, a lot of that's gone. Briefs are better and the oral arguments are better, and we keep telling the lawyers that. I had a lawyer who came down from New York to lecture to us peasants about some critical matter, and he fulminated for time, and then I stopped him, and he fulminated again, and I stopped him, and then a third time I said, counsel, how about coming up here to the bench? And said, you haven't been down here before. We don't practice law that way anymore. Just tell us what we need to know. And he said, well, Judge, how will I know? I'm not used to this sort of restraint. How will I know when I am when I'm invading your province of what you do. I said, I just raise my finger like that.
Got his attention. Judge, we've been talking about appellate advocacy, and I know this is a subject that's near and dear to your heart.
Yes, indeed.
And as one of your countless law clerks who ought to be in at least 70 or 80 range by now, if not more, I know that what is considered the Bible for us is the article you wrote in 1976, the Law Review article on appellate advocacy, 20 pages in 20 minutes. You hold very firmly to the belief that that's sufficient for any good appellate argument. Am I right?
Most cases, yes.
And while you've been chief of both 5th and 11th Circuit, have you found ways to almost make that a mandatory requirement?
Well, of course, on a lot of the cases now, the allowable time is 20 minutes rather than 30. We have very few 30-minute cases anymore. And if you've got a case of any complexity, you better get to explaining it in a hurry. And the court nudges people along in the oral argument, says, look, how about moving along on this? So maybe you finish this point, why don't you take up the second? And it's been cut. I'd like to see 20 at least in every case, but the trick is how to utilize it. And going back to something I was talking about a few minutes ago, counsel's got to know what the problem is and tell us what the problem is and what happened and what you want us to do about it, and tell us in a hurry. You'd be surprised how frequently we get to the tail end of an argument and one of the judges will say, suppose we agree with you, what kind of order are we going to enter? Oh, my Lord, I never thought of that. And the answer is, a fair order. Oh, I know you'll do what's right and so on, but just tell us what you want us to do. And we've managed, and also by talking to lawyers a lot, we've managed to get this compressed down. And the opinions are so much shorter. Don't tell me a lot of stuff I don't need to know. The automobile accident, I don't care whether it was a green 1948 Chrysler. And we've got that, getting that out of it, and continue to do so.
All right. Judge, with the career that is as lengthy as yours, it's impossible in the allotted time for us to explore so many facets of your career. So I'm going to give you the opportunity to choose, and I'd like to do it by asking you to look back on your tenure with the old Fifth Circuit, or if you prefer, simply your status as an active circuit judge after you left the old Fifth, in whichever manner you prefer. And just tell us what you're proudest of in terms of your accomplishments while you were chief of the old Fifth or chief of the 11th Circuit.
Well, I'm proud of the fact that with a lot of help from a lot of people, we were able to get the circuit divided. It created two courts that are much more workable. And with a lot better spirit. And it's really beyond the range of doing that more than touching on it, but we were able to, at a very early stage, get our operations computerized far ahead of the other courts in the country. Fortunately, we had a real expert and on our staff, and everybody's, I suspect, beautifully computerized by now, but we were a year or 2 years ahead of most of the rest of them. The some of the things I'm the proudest of relate to Florida, which has had a succession of matters. The most difficult one was, well, I won't say it, a very difficult one was the fact that Florida had more people on death row than any state except Texas. And they simply ran out of lawyers to handle death penalty cases. The lawyers who felt, who would handle the cases because they think death penalty is wrong, and the highly motivated lawyers who for other reasons would take them, they just ran out. And the Bar Association wasn't interested. The Supreme Court of Florida wasn't interested. The Attorney General of Florida was saying that it suited him fine. We were meddling in their business all the time. And the Governor of Florida was not interested. And we were able to get this resolved in a way that I'm very proud of. We got to Florida Bar. The president dragged him almost hand and foot into a meeting and caught his interest. We got the Supreme Court chief, got a new chief and got his support. The question is how to get lawyers at large interested in it. But we'd been working to get public relations to young lawyers and one office lawyers and so forth. It wasn't working. And we concluded that the best thing to do was to go for the big boys. And I got a wonderful guy who used to be president of the Florida Bar and filled him in on it. And he started personally visiting the biggest law firms in Florida. And he'd sit down with his senior partners and say, I want you to furnish me one lawyer for one case. And don't send me a new associate, send me one of your fully trained lawyers, one case. Well, that's pretty hard to turn down. And before long, he had 25 lawyers from 25 big firms lined up, and they performed beautifully. It so interested the bar, I had to get him organized, the president of the bar. He got on the stick, and the Florida Bar put up $100,000 to fund an office to help lawyers who had death penalty cases and didn't know what to do. These were Florida Bar funds. The Attorney General agreed to help and stopped fussing about death penalty cases. The Governor of Florida helped and stopped signing so many death warrants. And before long, the whole problem was under control. The second thing that happened from this is other states began setting up similar offices. Georgia came along, Alabama came along. And before we were finished, over half of the states had offices helping the death penalty lawyers and federally funded. Now, the federal government has withdrawn a lot of its support, but that's all right. It took five, mm-hmm. 6, 8 years, and it all got rolling, and now it's going along fine.
So you were really activist as a chief judge and overseeing the district courts to be sure that these things were in place when they needed to
That's
be,
right.
whether at the state level or at the district court level.
And they're getting there. The habeas corpus death penalty cases are. I can't handle the trial end, but we can handle it at the prelude end. The lawyers are in place, and it's working along fine. And it was done from a ground zero. Of course, the second thing we had in Florida was the Hastings impeachment.
Congressman L.C. Hastings, who was formerly a federal judge.
The statute requires us to appoint a committee to investigate that when there's a complaint like this, of this nature. He was charged with taking money and also with using forged instruments at his trial, because he'd been tried and acquitted. And judges signed an administrative complaint against him, and we appointed a committee of five people, and we worked for 3.5 years. And the final report is about this thick. And the Judicial Council of our circuit approved it unanimously. The Judicial Conference of the United States approved it unanimously. Sent it to the House Committee, chaired by a black congressman. And the House Committee said, we approve it. Issue the impeachment charge, and it went to Congress, and Congress approved it. And it took us 3.5 years of work, half time, I'd say. And I can't talk too much about it because under the statute says it's confidential. Mm-hmm. Well, a lot of it is no longer confidential because Congress began to let it go out. Mm-hmm. But it was done, and it was some accomplishment.
Was that your greatest administrative challenge after you?
It was
you?
The biggest challenge we had. I was, among other things, I was in 8 different cases about it, about elements of the thing as we went along. I got sued every month or two by somebody. Mm. I filed a suit. It's the most complicated impeachment thing in history. There's just nothing like it before. And we had hundreds of witnesses. We've got thousands of documents. And I can tell you this much without breaching confidentiality. One of the central figures who worked with us for nearly 3 years, getting himself in position to be a participant in the money business, who purported to be a criminal defendant who was asking Judge Hastings to help him, was a retired FBI agent who came out of retirement to play this role for 2 to 3 years. And his life was at stake time after time, and he never batted an eye. Mm. And anyhow, that's enough about that. And the third Florida thing is, I don't know what's better than the other. District Court in Florida got in very bad shape. The cases weren't getting done enough. The leadership was failing. The judges weren't getting along. You wouldn't believe it, but you could file a paper in the clerk's office, and it went in a cardboard box, sometimes out in the hall, and it might not even be on the court records for a week. Well, this required major action. The Chief Justice talked about whether our circuit court could intervene. We couldn't find any statutory authority to do so. I finally said, Chief, the first thing we need is some study of this court from top to bottom by an authorized auditing agency from the administrative office. And they sent their best auditors down there, and they came out with a report about this thing that is just scathing. And I handed that to the chief. I said, Chief, here's a report, and here's you look at this and this and this and this. And then talked to me again. He looked at those things and said, I want y'all to clean it up. I said, well, Chief, I don't have any authority to do that. He said, I'm going to get you the authority. And he had a letter delivered to me at our judicial conference. He timed it, I think, when it was in session. Not by mail, but brought by a courier. And it said, I authorize and direct you and the Judicial Council of your circuit to address this matter and to clear it up. Sincerely yours. I don't think he had any legal authority, but he damn sure had actual authority.
And you acted pursuant to that authority.
We acted pursuant to that. And the five major components of a district court staff, one was indicted, three retired because we told them they had to, and one in the office was abolished. I think one of the five survived. And we got the judges straight, and also the chief had said, I'll do what I can to help you. And I had to go to Washington several times, and he said, what do you got in mind today? I said, I need 40 judges each to try one big case. And he called on the circuits, and they sent 40 judges down there each to try a monster case and get the monster cases done. And that took 2 years, but, after about 2 years, got a new chief judge, the old one stepped down. Took 2 years of real hard working to make to get this done, and now they're in good shape.
You were definitely busy as chief judge.
Oh gosh, and I'm real proud of this one. And that's it about Florida, and I was, that's sort of it about things of great scope.
While you were chief judge, I know in particular, you had occasion to interact with a number of the justices on the U.S. Supreme Court, and perhaps even before you became chief. Is there anything you can share with us about your interactions with some of them?
Well, Justice Black was our circuit justice, they call him, circuit justice, when I came on. Because he was good in all matters, but he was especially good at speaking at the conference to new judges. He could just set them on fire. Wonderful speech about their responsibilities and what they could expect and so on. And we had Justice Powell. He was supportive of us in every possible way. He was a quiet, low-key sort of person, but he knew what was going on and he knew how to help us. When we were striving to get started with computerization and couldn't get the necessary computer equipment, he simply got it for us. We presented him a program of how we'd use it in monitoring death penalty cases all over the circuit. We showed it to Justice Powell, and he took it down the hall to the chief, and the chief said, do it. And Justice Powell was always interested in and helpful in all our matters. Justice Kennedy, same way. Kennedy's a doer and wonderfully personable and person to work with. And we were very fortunate. All three of our circuit justices were interested in the assignment. Some justices on the Supreme Court don't want to fool with what a circuit's doing. But those three were interested in the assignment, and maybe I shouldn't have said that about other justices, but anyhow, we were lucky in our choices. Mm-hmm.
Judge, you stayed active with the, and I mean active as carrying your full load as a judge for about 20 years. And I believe it was on September 3 of 86 that you took senior status. And your judicial career took only a slightly different turn when you became director of the Federal Judicial Center. I want to share with the audience a little about that period between 1986 and 1990 when you left your home and went to Washington, D.C. How was that experience? And tell us, first of all, about some of the teaching and training functions performed by the center at that time.
Well, they're the primary agency for teaching judges and other court persons, not just judges, clerks, financial officers, all sorts of people, marshals, probation officers. And they carry this on in largely in programs at convenient places over the country, sometimes Washington. And one of the primary functions is a week's training for every new judge. I always wanted it to be 2 weeks, but we couldn't get that. And the new judges just come to Washington and go through a week's training. When I was there, the great research effort was computerization and automation of the courts. But also the research, the center researches particular legal problems, either it may be at the behest of the judicial conference, maybe at its own behest, and it may be over committees of Congress that are asking questions about legislation. And we had a good research section that of good people who knew how to research and write. When I went to Washington, I had been on the board of the center for 4 years, and I was reasonably familiar with what it did. But very quickly, I drafted three judges who had no connection with the center and whose opinions I had great regard, and asked them to come to Washington. And we locked the door, and for 3 days, we analyzed the federal judicial statutes and anything else, federal judicial center statutes, and anything they might directly relate to. And we ended up with a chart showing exactly what the Congress said we were supposed to do. One of the first things I discovered was that they'd given us several things that we couldn't possibly do. For example, to supervise the Justice Department computer system. So we told the board of the center that we could forget about those. We weren't going to try to do them. And then we focused on the duties I've outlined. When I arrived there, I found that some of the research was not under the kind of control that I thought was correct. Research was being done that was somebody requested directly from the research staff, with the director never knowing about it. And I found they were working on projects that I didn't know about. It was not invidious, it was just the way they'd fallen into. And we got all the control of research centralized. And they couldn't do independent inquiry. Some committee of judges would call on them to do so-and-so, and maybe it wasn't a good inquiry at all. And it's a good agency, continuing well in its wake. It had a little lag for 2 or 3 years when there were some personnel problems that have been solved now. It's a very bright woman judge from California who heads it now. Mm-hmm. And there's a little overlap between it and the administrative office, but we managed to work those things out. For example, peculiarity in the statute that says the administrative office shall train not marshal judges, but I don't know, I've forgotten. Anyhow, some lower level functionary for the system. They didn't have any training section to do this. So we did the job, and they paid us a stipend of about $1 million a year to do this for them. So it spreads out in many ways. I have to explain quickly, anytime anybody asks me about the judicial center, that I did not make my own selection. The Chief Justice asked me to be on a selection committee, which set a meeting for Boston at 11 o'clock in the morning, and everybody else was told to come at 10. When I arrived at 11, they horsed around a little bit, and then they said, well, you don't have to spend much time here. We've already made a selection. And I thought, oh, God, what I've gotten myself into, that there's something, is the Chief Justice selected somebody, or are they running in somebody that can't do it? I said, well, tell me. And they said, well, you're it. So that's how I got to be the chief, and I required them put out a press relief that pointed out that I didn't participate in the committee's deliberations. But it's a good agency.
Good.
And
it still functions as the principal teaching and training arm for federal judges.
Yes. The computerization is more centralized now in the administrative office because they furnish all the equipment.
Wasn't it during your tenure, Judge, that the sentencing guidelines came out and the new judges had to be trained?
Yes.
And
yes.
You were principally responsible for overseeing that?
Yeah. It came out almost at the time I was there. And then there was one funny condition that said they would go into effect October the 1st unless Congress held otherwise. So we sat around not knowing whether to train people or what, and we got it done.
I believe also it was under your tenure that all federal appellate judges in the nation met in a conference for the first time?
First time they'd ever done that. Now I think they do it
regularly.
Regularly.
Mm-hmm. From the Federal Judicial Center to Cumberland Law School, when you left Washington, came back to Alabama, how did you decide to go into teaching during your senior status as a judge?
Well, I'd had friendly connections with Cumberland over the years and with its dean. And when I came back to Alabama, he called and asked me if I was interested in teaching there. And I said, well, Dean, what do you want me to teach? He said, anything you want to. So I thought about it, and I produced a two-hour course that amended a bit, but I continue to teach. It's primarily how to handle a district court case from the time you investigate it till it's decided, step by step. What do you do next, and how much time have you got? Mm-hmm. And then a new inquiry, which is catching on a little now, of the process that goes on between the lawyer and his client on whether the case should be appealed. Mm. That's almost a virgin field. Now the case is lost. The old practice was, you know, you called your client and said, I'm sorry to tell you you lost. I'll send you a copy of it. Do you want to appeal? Yep. How much is it going to cost me? Well, now we're trying to generate interest in that as a real careful, thoughtful analysis made between lawyer and client. Then we move to an appeal, and what do you do next, and what comes next, and how do you go through all the steps in the appeal?
What do you find most attractive about teaching at this stage?
The interest of the young students.
And it's still keen at Cumberland?
Oh, yeah, we got them moving on. In my court classroom, we do, because, see, I'm dealing in concretes. Mm-hmm. I'm not discussing how do you analyze proximate causation. Mm-hmm. We're dealing in concretes, and how do you do what, and how do you do when, and why do you do it, and then what do you do next? And they've got to get familiar with the rules, Civil and 11th Circuit.
Judge, as you look back over your long career as a judge, how do you want to be remembered?
Oh, shucks. One, I suspect, first of all, Dolores, is I want to be remembered as fair. I want to be remembered as thoughtful in finding out what the issues are and what we ought to do about them. And I want to be remembered for being a faithful administrator. Because whatever the issues that are involved in a solving a case is not meaningful unless it's done correctly. Does it done procedurally correctly? You can't get the work done correctly if you don't follow the procedures.
It's interesting, Judge, that your own self-analysis and your own vision of your legacy coincides almost precisely with the reasons you were chosen in 1996 for what has been called by Judge Rooney, your colleague and friend, as the Heisman Trophy for federal judges.
Well, I was just lucky.
I think it goes beyond
luck, Judge.
Of course,
you've got another quotation there from Paul Rooney that I'm so proud of that I think is...
It was Judge Rooney who said, Judge Godbold has the capacity to communicate concepts to others, and once the concept has been expressed, to persuade others to bring it to fruition, and then to either stand in the fore or withdraw to the background, whichever seems best. Of all the commentary from all the distinguished jurists, when you received this most prized distinction at the ceremony in 1996, I thought that Judge Rooney's comment seemed to embrace all that your entire career as a lawyer and a judge has stood for. It goes right back to communication. It goes right back to advocacy.
Well, Judge Rohn is a great judge and a wonderful friend.
A former winner of that award, Judge Weiss, also talked about your skills at administration when he said that you'd always grasped the importance of judicial administration in bringing justice to the litigants. I want to ask you about a couple of things about that award. Of course, you were in outstanding company when you received it in 1996. I believe that there had been 16 before you, and Justice Kennedy, who chaired the selection committee, called it the most prized distinction that federal judges can confer upon one of their colleagues, and reminded the audience that Judge Frank Johnson before you, Judge Albert Tuttle, and Judge John Wisdom, all your colleagues, either on the 5th or 11th, had been among the honorees, as had Chief Justice Berger. I found interesting your comments, and I just want to remind you of what you said in part and ask your reaction a little bit to your philosophy today. Let me remind you of these remarks, Judge. You said, "My colleagues and I have been lucky to be judges at a time when great changes and adjustments were occurring in the life of our country. And to participate in those changes, such as the right of citizens to vote and to serve on juries, the right of citizens to be fairly represented in legislative bodies, the right of our people to decent care in our mental hospitals and to civilized treatment in our prisons, and the right for all of us not to be treated as second-class citizens because of race or gender. My first question to you is, was it really lucky to be embroiled in all of that controversy?
Oh, it surely was. It surely was. Being a circuit judge is maybe the best job, judicial job in the country. Being a circuit judge in the Southeast, where we have a particular set of problems to be wrestled with, maybe it's the best of all those. We've been much more challenged, much more is demanded of us in finding solutions than people in other areas, than many people in other areas of the country. This has been where the cutting edge is. And we've been fortunate to be here and to participate in it.
The dissension and the controversy, the stress, particularly with the Deep South judges, none of that detracted from your feeling of good fortune and being a part of that era?
Not me. Well, there were, and we saw very little of it, surprisingly. There were just one or two instances in the South in which we felt people didn't carry the load as they should. But most judges may have grumbled a little bit, but sometimes, everybody was trying to address the problems of our country and to do something about them.
The second question, Judge, many of your colleagues, and I suspect that you were included in the number, were criticized in some in some areas for what's been euphemistically called now judicial activism during that period. How do you respond to that charge, that what the old Fifth Circuit in particular and some of the district court judges did went beyond their constitutional mandate?
Most of the time, judicial activism is a catchword that describes a viewpoint that I don't like. And that's first point. Second point is, that really doesn't bother me because the problem is presented to the judge. His job is to decide, and he decides. Almost no judge is, one, he doesn't ask for the papers to come to his desk. Somebody else thought them up, and somebody filed them, and they're properly assigned to him. Second, with him on his desk, the worst thing he can do is not act. The process of dispute resolution among individuals or bodies or groups is a call for action. It's not a call to read something and forget it. It's a call to present this dispute to a dispute decider and then to suggest a solution. That ain't activism. That's doing what you're supposed to do. Now, once in a while, a remedy for a change in a situation may be too harsh, but there are appellate restraints on that, and Lord, we'd be in a heck of a shape if a judge couldn't be active because he's called on to deal with this dispute. And he can't make it just go away. And he's by definition, like saying a quarterback ought to be inactive. This is his task. And it falls to him purely by accident or by structure that he has no control over. And in the one or two instances in the darkest days when we had one or two district judges that chickened out, well, all they drew was contempt from the rest of us. But we didn't have, had surprisingly little of that, considering the nature of the difficult problems. So I'll tell you one wonderful story about that is Judge Guin on our court was very troubled by the accommodation provisions of the Civil Rights Act of 1964. It bothered him very much. Finally, we had a case in bank that involved a question of whether a skating rink, a paid skating rink, is a public accommodation under the statute. And it got around to him to state his view. Everybody thought he was going to say, hell, that's not a public accommodation. They're talking about places to eat and sleep. He said, I think it's a public accommodation. So I'll have to tell you all that they took away the little girl's skates, and I couldn't stand that. Court never let him forget it. Some case thereafter, he'd start to speak. Somebody said, Walter, tell us about taking away the little girl's skates. And she cried.
Judge, your response brings to mind for me one of the most compelling articles you've written about the role of the Constitution in our lives. Your comments about judicial activism brings to mind this article, and it was published and reprinted in the Cumberland Lawyer, the winter 1995 issue. I want to remind you of something you said that and said in this article, and conclude this interview with your recollection of the importance of our living Constitution, because even today in 2001, cold phrases like judicial activism, and strict constructionists, all of those are often used to prevent us from really examining the real role that the Constitution ought to play in the lives of ordinary Americans. In your article, you wrote, some time ago, after I wrote a decision that a prisoner under death sentence must be given a new trial because his trial had violated the Constitution, I received a letter from an anonymous man who threatened death to my family and me. I notified the proper authorities. The point of telling you this is that the writer ended his letter this way, and I quote, I got no use for a constitution that lets this terrible murderer and rapist have another trial, end of quote. You use that incident, Judge, to bring home in a most compelling way the role of the Constitution in the lives of people just like that gentleman, I assume, yes, the gentleman who wrote you. I can think of no better way, Judge, to conclude this interview than having you reaffirm, as you did in that article, your strong feelings about our Constitution as a living document that has importance in the role of every American citizen. And I'd like to ask you just to expand on that response just a little bit.
Well, the Constitution touches so many things that we accept really without thought. You and I can travel anywhere we want to in the United States without a government card authorizing us. We can go to a movie that some people may not like because we wish to. We can cast our ballot for people for public office. If the state wants 20 feet off the front of my lot for public use. They can get it, but they have to pay me for it. You and I can buy and read whatever books we want. We can go to whatever church we want. We can attend public schools, full schools financed by the government, or we can opt out and go to schools we want to go to. The list is just so long that everything we do every day in our lives, not everything, but a great many things we do every day in our lives are just wonderful constitutionally guaranteed freedoms that come only because we have a constitution. And secondly, they come only when judges who are asked what the Constitution means do their best to define and explain them.
Hmm. You ended that article, Judge, with the most powerful reminder of what we as lawyers and non-lawyers sometimes forget. You said, we need not carry the Constitution around in our coat pockets. What is much more important is that we in the legal profession carry it in our minds, not as a series of problems in a constitutional law classroom, intellectual sound bites, but as a powerful living force that affects the lives of all Americans in innumerable ways. Those of us in the legal profession know and understand this. We just forget it, or more accurately, fail to think about it. And when the Constitution is under stress, fail to tell others what we know and understand. Yet it lives. It does live. Judge, on behalf of all of the countless lives, the people you've touched and enriched, your clients in the city and county of Montgomery and the state of Alabama, the lawyers you've interacted with, the judges who've been your colleagues, the law clerks who've learned from you, and the citizens whose lives have been enriched because of your own resounding determination that the Constitution live. I want to thank you for your own life and the legacy you've left here, not just in the Middle District of Alabama, but in this entire nation. I thank you for sharing with us just a little bit of those forces that have shaped this wonderful character that you are today. And I thank you for your patience in letting me interview you so that others, many, many, many years after I've passed and gone, will know that John C. Godbold was an honorable man whose life is worth emulating. Thank you very much, Judge.
Thank you so much, Dolores.